Despite his family's generations-old ban on music, young Miguel dreams of becoming an accomplished musician like his idol Ernesto de la Cruz. Desperate to prove his talent, Miguel finds himself in the sunny and colorful land of the dead. After meeting a charming trickster named Hector, the two new friends embark on an extraordinary journey to unlock the real story behind Miguel's family history. Welcome to another feature presentation from Midnight Double Feature, and today we're going to be talking about Coco, directed by Lee Unkrich and Adrian Molina. Colin, you're probably wondering why I got you to watch a kids movie.
Yeah, I was kind of thinking about that because I'm not going to lie, like I'm not a super huge Disney kind of guy. So, you know, like, yeah, I was kind of like, okay, this is different, but I can handle it. I can handle it.
Yeah, yeah. I was like, because we were choosing the next movie to cover after Watchmen, and I was like, I'm going to throw out a fucking curveball here. I'm going to do something that we haven't done before, and I don't think any of our other friends' podcasts have done it, right? I mean, like, well, I mean, you know, LSG's covered the Iron Giant and things like that, but nothing sort of like animated like this, right? I think they had Wall-E on the cards recently.
But, yeah, and especially something so, like, when did this come out? This is actually pretty recent, isn't it?
Yeah, end of last year.
Yeah, this is, God, this might be the most recent movie we've covered, actually. Like, I know we did, like, a review of Infinity War, but, you know, that's, but yeah, wow, that's, yeah, that's, I didn't even think about that. That's like the, this is like the, because you know me, I'm over here like, yeah, Flatliners, you know, I'm thinking of stuff that came out when I was like two. So, like, to do something like Coco that's an animated thing, but also at the same time, I mean, if you want to call it a kids movie, yeah, I mean, I guess it is technically a kids movie, but at the same time, it's got some pretty heavy themes, and that's what kind of pulled me towards it and wanted to do it, because if it was just something like, oh, hey, we're going to do Frozen, I'd be like, no, like, I'm sorry, like, I can't do fucking Frozen,
yeah.
Man.
Yeah, that's exactly why I chose this movie. I was like, because I saw this at the movie, and you know what? I'm gonna fucking go first with my opening thoughts, bitch. Because you stole it from me once before, and I was just like, you know what? Fuck you, Colin. I'm coming right back.
I knew that coming was gonna right come back. Back on me.
No, I watched this at the movies, man. Back when it was out, and man, this thing's fucking great. I'm not one of those people who kind of just, oh, it's a kid's movie, so it's probably not as good. Like, you know, I think Pixar, especially Pixar, Pixar is one of those companies that are just like, we don't just create kids' movies. And they've proved that from like almost every time, you know, Cars notwithstanding. And yeah. Toy Story was one of my favorite kid movies as a kid. That movie shaped, I think, generations. Toy Story 1, 2, and then in 2010, Toy Story 3. That movie was also incredible. Like, holy shit.
Yeah, it's fucking dark.
It's fucking dark. Directed by the same guy that did this, by the way. Yeah, man. Yeah, Lee Unkrich is his name. But not only Toy Story, dude. Finding Nemo. You can, I guess, talk about how it might not be as, I guess, deep as this. I think this Coco might be the deepest sort of Pixar movie that we've had. But, I mean, every Pixar movie is about something that relates to real life. Like, Finding Nemo is about fatherhood, right? Toy Story is about, you know, overcoming jealousy and things like that. Because, I mean, you know, new toy.
Yeah,
you know,
right,
you know?
Yeah, and, like, growing up and letting things go, yeah, and shit like that.
Exactly. Wall-E. Wall-E is also incredible as well. Have you seen Wall-E?
Yeah, I was going to say, actually, I think Wall-E's my favorite one, honestly, because I think I went and saw that in theater. You know, Wall-E,
Wall-E.
That was definitely my favorite one. Just to see how, like, everybody sits in those chairs the whole time. They're constantly eating and drinking. I'm like, yeah, right. that's pessimistic 28-year-old me. Like, yep, that's what it's going to end up being like.
See, but, that's what I'm saying. Like, it's a kid's movie, but it also really hones in on real life, you know, relatable things. And I think that's where Pixar really, really shine. You know what I mean? Have you seen Ratatouille? Ratatouille is really damn good as well. Really, really recommend that. That's directed by Brad Bird, who did The Incredibles, another Pixar movie, and he did Tomorrowland. He did Mission Impossible 4. He's a good director as well. But I that being said, I don't think anything is as heavy as Coco. When I saw Coco at the movies, I broke down multiple times. And I break down every time I've seen it. I've seen it 3 times now. Once in the cinemas, once a few weeks ago, and once for the, well, not really for the podcast. I know I cheated. I was like, it's pretty fresh in my head, so I didn't watch it again. But every time I'm seeing it, man, it just kind of like, it chips away at me. Only because it's presented so well. And it really does a really good job of like evoking emotion. I did like a little thing that I don't really do with our podcast, and that's I kind of like typed up a little. It's not really an essay. It's like a little. It's kind of like a little opening thoughts kind of thing. So I'm just gonna. Well, I'll read it, but you know, we can feel free to jump in wherever. But yeah, this was a heavy movie for me. I just wrote. This is a story about many things, and it's absolutely fascinating how much they were able to fit into the runtime. Because honestly, this is an hour and 47 movie, and they fit in so much. And it's obviously a fantasy movie, so they also have to sell us on all of these like these crazy crazy concepts, you know, that are really like culturally relevant. Mm-hmm. So it's crazy how they're able to do that in the runtime. But ultimately, this is a movie about family and art. And in the movie, both of these things kind of go hand in hand. The movie talks about whether you should compromise your desire to create that art based on what's expected of you by your family. And that, to me, is fascinating right there. It's something that you don't really see in movies, I think. It's a really, really unique thing to this movie, and I was just like totally blown away by that theme in general. This whole idea of being able to create your own identity and wanting to escape from the traditional values that are expected of you. But then the movie also has this whole other sort of side of it that talks about the importance of remembering your loved ones when they've passed on and the strength that remembrance has in the afterlife. Talks about the importance of tradition and why it's necessary to uphold the traditional ways that's been passed down between generations, whilst also putting a spotlight on the importance of carving out your own personal identity through creating art. Now, I know I reference them all the time, but Kevin Smith's podcast, Fat Man on Batman, his co-host Mark Bernardin talks about how art isn't always absolutely your original idea. The final product isn't always what you envisioned before you started. Oftentimes, to create art, like music or film or whatever, you need to make compromises, give things up here and there, collaborate. So in that way, art is almost always a result of compromise. And that's what this movie, I guess, at its core is trying to sort of say. You know, it's not to, if you want to create music, you're going to have to find a middle ground. You're going to have to make some compromises. Like, look at our podcast, for example, Colin. When we started the podcast, I mean, we always had this idea of we're going to cover these movies, we're going to go through them, talk about them, talk shit about them, have fun. But then I kind of like threw out, hey, let's also, you know, here and there maybe cover some news. And now we're getting, you know, some pretty good feedback about the news episodes. Joe Polcini, for one, posted recently on our page, you know, he really digs the news and the way we deliver the news. So thanks for that, Joe.
Sweet old Joe.
I know. Thanks for inflating our heads.
Also, another local Tennessean. That's nice.
He's fucking badass, man. I love that guy. But yeah, so that's so, I mean, like where the podcast is now, it's not how we initially sort of envisioned it from the start. If that makes sense, if you get what I'm saying here.
Yeah. I think there's a lot of time where if you, you know, if you're trying to force something to come out like a certain way. It's way better to just kind of, well, it's like throwing a deck of cards out and it's like, okay, well, I want this one face down. I want this one face up. I want just throw the deck of cards and see what lands and see what kind of ends up happening. Because more than likely, the people that you're collaborating with and the people that you're working with aren't going to sit there and every single thing you throw out be like, oh, yeah, oh, yeah, oh, yeah. There's oftentimes,
right, that'll lead to disaster.
Right. Yeah. It's just in that, and you constantly feel like you're working with someone who's not challenging you and not right, like
that'll lead to the Star Wars prequels where George Lucas was throwing everything out and everyone's like, yeah, sounds good.
Oh, yeah, sure. Yeah, sure. But yeah, I definitely agree because it's good to, it's like you were talking about with compromise. You know, it's also with this movie does a good job of talking about compromising, you know, to the point where, you know, when they talk about De La Cruz, it's like, you know, did you have to, you could have played on a smaller scale and still stayed with your family. You know, there's still things like that you can, you know, you can compromise. You don't have to have the whole world and leave everything else behind. I mean, you can if that's really, really what you want to do. But most people aren't like that. Most people want a healthy balance of life and work and play and fun. And I think this movie does a good job of kind of, well, I guess in itself, compromising that and making those two bridges meet at the end of the movie, making it feel like he's also able to play music. And at the same time, he's you know, he's had his arc. He's learned his lesson. He is more respective about the more respective about the traditions that they have. And isn't really, you know, it's not like he gets away without learning anything. He learns a lot. They learn from him as well. So there is a compromise even in their relationships, especially with the whole no music rule and stuff. It's kind of like they have their rules, you know, about, you know, no music, but, you know, we want you to learn all this stuff. And he's like the exact opposite. I don't care about any of this stuff. I just want to play music. And they kind of have to find that middle ground. I think they do a good job of doing that as well.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, man. What do you think of the movie overall, though?
I liked it. Like, I'm just not a big like Pixar guy. I like dark movies. I like horror movies. I like, you know, like I'm a big John Carpenter fan. You know, of course, one of the first movies I picked out of the gate was like The Void, you know? So it's like, that's kind of about around where I live, like kind of thing. And I can get out of that. You know, I'll watch Shawshank Redemption, which I fucking love, you know, or like if you've ever seen Bull Durham with Kevin Costner, like that was on the other day. I was like, oh, I'm going to watch this. I haven't seen this in a long time. It's a fucking baseball movie. You know, it's like totally not what I would watch. But I like it. I like it a fairly decent amount. I wouldn't own it. It's a good movie, but it just didn't blow my socks off, which is also because I was thinking of how to say this the best way, because there's no denying that it's a great movie. It's great, especially with the guitar playing and how the fingers and everything line up like as he's playing. That's incredible. The music is great. And it's not too much music to where it just feels like a straight up fucking musical. It has like more plot than like musical to it, which is great. And overall, I like it. I would give it, I think it's a little overhyped, just a little bit. I do think it's a really, really excellent movie, and I think it's worthy of the majority of the praise that it gets. But like, it just wasn't anything for me that just like blew me away. Like Toy Story 3 and WALL-E were things that like blew me away in terms of like Disney, you know, Pixar kind of movies. But it kind of reminded me, and I'm sure you've never seen this, but it came out in about 1997. It was an animated movie from Cartoon Network, and I guess like I think it's Hanna-Barbera or whatever. But it came out in 97. It's called The Halloween Tree. It's
can't say I've seen it.
Yeah, well, it's a book originally written by Ray Bradbury, who did Fahrenheit 451, and it's a children's book, and it's all about these four kids who end up learning about the rules and traditions of Halloween, and they go to like ancient Egypt, and they actually go to Dia de los Muertos. They go to like ancient Greece. They go to a lot of different places and learn about their traditions. And that kind of helped me ease into this movie because I fucking love Halloween Tree. That's like one of my favorite. That's like one of my earliest memories is watching this movie when I'm like six. It's kind of got the same kind of vibe to it, even down to like little kids starting to disappear and like die and stuff. It's heavy, man. It's really fucking heavy. But getting back to the movie we're talking about, I did like it. It just, like
stay
I said,
on target.
Yeah, it just didn't blow my socks off. I did enjoy watching it. But it's also, I, you know, for me, it's really hard for me to watch like a kid's movie, honestly. And I know it's a kid's movie with adult kind of themes, which definitely helped me through it. I was like, okay, this is a little bit darker. I can handle this. You know, I can't make it through like Finding Nemo or like Finding Dory. Like they're good movies and I've watched them enough.
I do have a note to talk about this though. But before we start the episode, I mean, look, it's a shorter movie, so we can sort of have like this little preamble here. So I guess we can talk about it a bit. Finish your thought, but yeah, I do want to get into what makes us sort of be a little bit more hesitant to watch kids' movies. Because when I showed this to my dad, he's like, oh, it's a kids' movie.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I mean?
Right. Like, it's the same thing I hate when people are like, I'm like, oh, do you watch like Futurama? Do you watch like Rick and Morty? Like, no, I don't watch cartoons. I'm like, all right, back the fuck up. That's not a cartoon. Okay. Like, that's like adult animation. All in all, like I said, I think it's a good movie. It's just not for me. Like, and that's really about the best that I can sum it up. There's nothing about the movie that I don't like it's not like, oh my god, you know, this is just the graphics look bad or the acting's terrible here, I don't understand this in the plot. Like they really, like, there aren't a lot of plot holes, even though there's a lot of rules with being dead and, you know, somebody has to remember you, and it's not like that, you know, because they set up a lot of that stuff pretty early on, and they stick to a lot of those rules because they become important later on with Hector and stuff like that, and that's really, really interesting. But all in all, you know, I, like I said, just not my kind of movie. I think it's a really, really good movie, but it's just not something for me personally, you know. But I fucking love, you know, shit like Monster Squad and In the Mouth of Madness and shit. So I'm a little out of home on this one, but at the same time, that doesn't stop me from like appreciating a really good movie, which it is. So all in all, you know, wouldn't own it, but it's a good movie, just not for me. That's pretty much it.
Yeah, that's fair enough, man. I mean, like, I can definitely understand that. I mean, like. But like getting back to, I guess, the hesitancy to watch a kids movie, that doesn't really happen to me much. Like I said, only because Pixar is so well established, and because they've proven to me multiple times that they can deliver a pretty heavy kids movie. Like this for me. I can watch sequels to any movie, like, you know what I mean? Like, I can sit there and watch a sequel to a movie and just enjoy it. You know, I don't. I can base it on its own merits and things like that. But this movie, what I love about this is that it's so original. It's original, and like what it also carries things like all these messages that are just so positive for children and things like that, whilst also telling us, I can't, it's really difficult to word. I'm trying to think of a way to put this. Like I definitely, you know, when you're like in the shower and you just like think.
Shower thoughts.
Yeah, shower thoughts. I was like, God, how am I going to word like why Coco appeals to me?
Well, and I think it's honest with kids a lot. It doesn't really try to sugarcoat or like bullshit anything. Yeah. Like, I think one of the main reasons I have a problem with Disney and Pixar is because nobody ever dies and stays dead. It's very rare that happens. Like, especially towards the end of a movie, they're never going to. I mean, it's a Disney Pixar movie. They're never going to do that. It's a kids movie. But at the same time with this, you have this whole world of people who are dead. It's kind of like a little Nightmare Before Christmas just kind of thing. But even then, they have a death, you know, that they consider the final death. And like, holy shit. I mean, you get a five or a 6 year old kid watching this and they're like, wait, final death? Like that sounds real fucking ominous, Dad. Like, what is this? Like, so I think it's great because it does kind of panhandle a little bit, but at the same time, you know, it's good about not not holding any punches when it's, you know, talking about death, especially with such a big family. And I'm sure a lot of kids who are watching this, you know, they have grandparents and people close to them that are, you know, probably in the next 5 to 10 years, you know, not going to be there or ill or know someone. So I think it's also kind of a good coping mechanism for kids where it's like, you know, what is death? And here's a movie where it's teaching us, you know, not to be afraid of that because we don't know what happens when you die. And it kind of gets into that detail just a little bit, but it dips its toe in enough just for, you know, to kind of poke some relevant questions at kids, but at the same time, not beat them over the head with it. So, you know, they're having nightmares and having to sleep in their kids' bed and sleep in their parents' beds and stuff.
I think, okay, so for me, I can only talk about myself. I can't really, you know, talk about anybody else's experience with this. So for me, every movie starts off, this is because I like to be an optimist. Every movie starts off as a 10 for me. And then as I watch it, I start reducing things, reducing points. Mm. So with this, there was like nothing. There was nothing that I disliked about this movie at all. For me, man, this is an absolute 10. I can't express to you how much I love this fucking movie. And look, we'll go into why when we actually talked in detail about it. But like, the reason I watched this movie was because it was nominated for an Oscar, and it won the Oscar. It won Best Animated Picture. And look, my friend Chris and I, every time he comes around to Oscar season, we start like we create a list and we go out every week or so, watch a couple movies, and just kind of like watch all the Oscar movies and things like that, and just, you know, decide and choose our Oscar picks. That's all we do because we're fucking nerds. and man, like I can tell you, last year I'm having a mind blank on last year's Oscar movies, but this was the one that kind of stood out for me. I was like, holy shit, man, this is not only one of the best movies, best animated movies I've ever seen, but it's one of the best movies I've ever seen. We had Shape of Water last year, Dunkirk, Lady Bird, Get Out, Phantom Thread, The Post, Three Billboards Outside Ebbing, Missouri. This, I think, absolutely deserves to be in that best motion picture of the year category. It shouldn't be relegated just because it's animated. I think animated movies, they also have this other hurdle that they have to jump that, you know, although we're animated, we have just as important a story to tell, with just as important themes and look, if anything, a harder way to tell it. We have to remain sort of pandering to children, but at the same time, we have to be serious about the themes. And I think this movie absolutely nails that.
Yeah, I think they do a good job of that with, you know, like, because my girlfriend Lindsay, she loves Finding Nemo, Finding Dory. So I've seen bits and pieces of them, and especially the Toy Story trilogy, which, I mean, apparently they're coming out with a Toy Story 4.
I posted in the after party. It's released that is May, I think, next year.
Oh, okay, cool. But yeah, I think they do it, especially with Toy Story, where, like, yes, dying is obviously, I mean, wow, that's what happens and that's terrible. But God, I mean, the thought of just being fucking abandoned by the people that you love, or being incinerated, or being like, you know, just thrown out like trash, like, fuck, man, that is dark. You know, that's like, holy shit. So yeah, I think they do a good job of, it's kind of like they're not pulling any punches, but it's a love tap. You know, it's not really, you know, we're not trying to beat you to death with this, but we're going to hit you. We're going to come in hard, but we're not going to land with this really hard punch. We're just kind of going to give you a little love tap. And it's cool because and it's always themes that would be harder for, I think, kids to wrap their heads around if you were just sitting down and talking to them, be like, yeah, and then when you die, you go into a hole in the ground. And they're, you know, these kids are like, what the fuck? So I think when you when you kind of show them, you know, that there are these traditions where people, you know, live on and you can possibly see other people, like, it kind of gives it the pull over into the, like, the, it's almost like a bit of tug and war. And it's like we're pulling over to the optimistic side just a little bit more, because we show that, you know, death is not necessarily the end of things. It could be the beginning of something else. We just don't know.
Right. And I think that's why I put this at the top of my list for Pixar movies, only because It has the most heaviest sort of theme to get across to children. And look, like I said, Pixar always choose heavy themes to get across to children. I mean, like, Finding Dory is not... It's definitely not. I don't think it even crosses the top 10 for me for Pixar movies. I love Finding Nemo, but Finding Dory, it doesn't cross the top 10, but it still chooses a heavy theme to come to express to kids, and that's sort of like mental health, right? Like because she's obviously having mental health issues. Believe it or not, that's definitely what that movie's about. Go back and watch it. but yeah, and you know, Monsters, Inc., you know, it's about being different. It's about overcoming adversity and things like that. So, I fucking love this movie. I love it. Unless you have anything else to say, I do have one more thing before we start the show. Do you have anything else regarding opening thoughts?
No, go ahead.
Okay, cool. So, friend of the show, Matt, was supposed to join us on the show.
Bitch.
He had drinks at his place yesterday. I couldn't go out because I had a friend's birthday, but I have seen like Snapchats and shit, and he was wasted. I woke up to a message this morning. I'm going to read it for you, and I'm going to read it exactly as it is typed. So, no, it's not me having a stroke on the other end. It's literally me reading it as it's typed. Not even hello. This is what I woke up to, by the way. Okay, I'm drunk and other stuff, AA. So I don't know about podcast called Time Hen Ready to Start and Maybe We See Burn. I'm also okay if I don't Mac or it.
Oh, capitals? Dude, I had to like bury my fucking face in the pillow.
Capitals? Capitals. Oh, hey, you know what'd be fun to thee? If I'm not awake, Rawadu, this I bet I bay tea. This would be funny. Tonsei Bon Kofo Podcat. I can't type in good right now. Thonbutt. You can probably tell that. Anyways, I love you and Collegeny is the legend, mate. Emolf Knight Dobele feature forever. Also, I'm proud of you, because, wow, you've done so well. Much though, hopefully, I wake up tomorrow, but I promise I won't.
What?
Pig. Oh, my God.
I'm still reading. Pig, I just remember, RD. Tomorrow, your mission, if you choose to accept it, is to call me when you record Not Davy Cairns, Maybe I Join. I love...
Oh my God, this is gold. Matt, I'm so sorry, but this is so fucking funny, man. We love you.
I love Civic. It's a great movie. But yeah, okay, good night. I love you, and I love Colin Tuber. It's Progovlin Corning for him. Grazaheb, and good morning, Coolio and Coco. Coco is a masterpiece. Great mov. Call me and you're recording. I hope I awake. Loving you, bro.
Well, that seals the deal. I got to go drink it with Matt.
Holy shit, man. Oh, I love you, Matt. Oh, he's going to fucking hate me for reading that. I don't give a shit.
That's so fucking funny.
I was like, I got to fucking read this. I'm going to read this on the air.
Well, yeah, he's got good right to celebrate, too. They just finished rapping on his short film. It's called She's Not Your Type. It's from Villa Film, so I'm definitely excited to check it out. But, yes, that is fucking hilarious, man.
Yeah, for sure. With that being said, let's fucking get into this, bitch.
All right.
We open with this montage. I guess it's a family history, right?
Yeah, they're just kind of going over his... I'm so sorry. What is the main character's name? Is it Miguel?
Miguel. Oh, yeah. By the way, we're going to butcher so many Mexican sort of names and accents. You know in Django when we held off on saying the N-word? That's not going to happen here. I am going to be racist as shit. Oh, by the way, even though we're covering a kids movie, we're going to be swearing our asses off, so don't fucking worry about that.
Yeah, there's an E for explicit on it. Fuck you. Don't play this with your kids in the car. I don't think you would have made it to this point yet.
Yeah, I know. I love that we did give the disclaimer like half an hour into the show.
Yeah, right.
So Santa Cecilia, Mexico. Imelda is the wife of a musician who leaves her and their 4-year-old daughter, Coco, to pursue a career in music. When he never returns, Imelda banishes music from her family's life and starts a shoemaking business with her family. What do you think of this opening montage? It's pretty unique. I definitely love the animation style, the way they kind of do it.
Yeah, I thought it was pretty cool, and it's some heavy exposition, but at the same time, we're trying to set up something that happened, I mean, generations ago. So you kind of have to. I mean, I think I don't mind the montage. I honestly can't think of another way you could possibly get all this information like out. And it's a kid story. It's almost like sitting down and having your parent read a book to you, like setting up the story. It's very simple, and they cut right to basics right away, and we get the foundations of the story. And it's not something that's hard for us, and we understand. And it's not bad exposition. We're trying to set up, like I said, something that happened decades ago. So it's good. I like it, and I do like the animation style. What are those little, like, I guess just almost like show cards? Or?
I'm not Mexican.
I was like, I guess this is just something almost like where you cut them out and you stretch the whole thing, you know, and it's got all the images in it. That's the only thing I could think of. But I liked it. It was pretty interesting. Paper things.
Absolutely. I think it's cool, man. Like, look, when you're a kid, you don't really... when you're a kid and you're watching a movie like this, you don't really know that it's exposition. And you don't really care that exposition is bad in film. Like, you're just like, oh, okay, so they're giving me information now, and I guess that's what I'm going to do with it.
Yeah.
You know? But yeah, we meet Coco, and dude, Coco, this is where I was like, this movie's going to make me cry, isn't it? 3 minutes in. Because Coco reminds me of my grandmother, who's passed away. And her last days was kind of like what Coco's kind of going through here. Obviously, they don't tell you, but she's exhibiting signs of dementia, mm-hmm. Where she's kind of forgetting things and things like that. And not to mention that Coco absolutely kind of looks like my grandmother. She's kind of got the braided hair. She's got the big nose, the big wide nose and shit like that. So I was like, oh man, here we fucking go. And plus the chin hairs, like, come on, man. Pixar's animation is ridiculous.
Yeah, especially any kind of water they have just looks incredible. I don't know why why that sticks out to me more than anything, but it's like, holy shit, it just looks gorgeous.
Dude, anytime water is, like, rendered really well, I, like, lose my shit as well. I remember when I played Grand Theft Auto 4 back in the day, I was like, holy shit, look at this water. But, Mama Coco has trouble remembering things, but it's good to talk to her anyway. So Miguel pretty much tells her everything, you know, dimple, no dimple, dimple, no dimple.
You want to know something funny? That's actually a trait of the kid who does the voice. Like, he actually he has one dimple on one side, but not the other. And I can't remember. It might have been in Colombia. I can't remember where, but apparently they had to change the name from Coco to Vida. It's in Brazil. The title name was changed to Viva, for the original title Coco could easily be mistaken for the Portuguese word. It looks like Coco again, I guess, Coco, which translates to poop, but the word Coco without the accent and the letter O means the fruit of the palm tree of which coconut water is extracted. It's like, wow, it's like one word that means like four fucking different things. But yeah, it's not that funny. Coco is literally like shit in another language, and they're like, oh, we gotta change that.
Oh god. And look, and what I like about this movie as well, it also, it doesn't really need to be in Mexican heritage. It doesn't need to be the Mexican culture. It can sort of branch out to whatever, because look, my last name is Ali. So I mean, obviously, you figure it out. But I mean, this moment where they're at the dinner table and the abuela, is offering Miguel some food, and Miguel's like, no, I'm good. And she's like, I asked if you would like more tamales.
Yeah, like that. Like, dude,
yeah, the ethnic kind of like grandmother or auntie like feeding you until your fucking buttons burst off your shirt. That's a thing.
Oh, dude, that transcends like so many cultures. Like my own grandmother's that way, dude. Yeah. I think all grandmothers just built that way.
That's what I'm saying, man. Like, there are moments about this. There are moments in this movie that absolutely go beyond the cultural thing. There's another moment, especially that I'll get to soon. Actually, it's right here. You actually find out that Abuelita, the grandmother, she's putting the photos on the ofrenda. They call it the ofrenda, but I guess it's kind of like a shrine, right?
Yeah, I guess it's kind of like a mantle, you know, just just a table, mantle, some kind of thing.
Yeah, look, I'm going to go into a bit about me, because this is a really sort of personal movie, so I guess you're going to find out a little bit more about me. Ali is my last name, as I just said, so that comes from, that's Islamic, so no, I'm not a terrorist. my parents aren't, you know, they're not overly sort of religious. They don't wear the garb or anything like that, but they do pray, only because, you know, dad's lost, unfortunately, his parents and things like that. So he wants to, this thing here, this sort of like placing the photo on the shrine so you can remember your family, that plays into the Islamic sort of religion where you kind of pray for your family. They call it the dua. Dua. And it just, it kind of stuck out to me. I was like, they're telling a story here that like not only applies to sort of Mexican culture and the Day of the Dead and the remembrance, but it's also something that plays into other cultures as well. And I thought that was really unique. That's a really good way to tell the story.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure.
But yeah, not a terrorist.
Still going to get a tough time going through airport security, but not a terrorist.
Oh, absolutely. I have to shave before I go through airport security. CIA, ASIO, I hope you're hearing me. Listen to me. Not a terrorist. But also, yeah, during this sort of like montage of like no music, we get the did you notice the Pizza Planet truck?
I on the second time now that I'm watching it, I did. I had to kind of cheat and saw the trivia, and I was like, but I caught it the second time.
Yeah, man, the Pizza Planet truck from Toy Story, fucking great, great moment. But yeah, essentially, we get some narration here. Basically, Miguel's just saying, "Look, I like music, and music is what I want to do. But you know, I'm kind of brought down by my." By my family's tradition, just to create shoes. I don't want to do that. So immediately, this was the hook for me. I was, when I watched this for the first time, I was kind of like in this sort of creative space, as we are now. podcasting to me is this sort of like creative outlet that I allow myself. Like, I mean, I study, I work, and you work as well. There's no really sort of like creative sort of outlet that I have. So this kind of like really stuck out to me.
Yeah, I definitely like there's something that I think that the movie does a great job of like you said, like transcending like a lot of, I mean, it's a movie about, you know, like Mexican culture and Mexican traditions and heritage and passing things down to the next. But I mean, that transcends so much, which is interesting, because, you know, we have it's kind of like there's just things in your family that you do, and at some point you don't even stop to question them. It's like, why do we do this? It's like, we just don't do it. It's just always what we've always done. And I think that goes a long way for this family as well. Like, you know, I don't think that Miguel's the only one who enjoys music. I mean, it's music. I mean, how could you ban music? You know, but at the same time, that tradition is so much more important to them than breaking the cycle of it. But I mean, that's kind of why I like Miguel. That's another good reason that I like this movie, is that it's, you know, I understand that this is a tradition, but at some point we do need to question our traditions and wonder, why do we do these things? And, you know, you've got to, if this is something that you really think that you're supposed to do or that you're meant to do, you kind of have to run against the grain, even if it rubs some people the wrong way.
Absolutely, man. We get introduced to Ernesto de la Cruz. Ernesto de la Cruz.
The world's biggest head.
That's Pixar for you. He's voiced by Benjamin Bratt. He's pretty famous. He's a musician, a popular actor, and a pretty famous singer of Coco's generation. He died in the 40s, got crushed by a bell.
Yeah.
Jesus. That was pretty crazy. But yeah, Miguel really, really looks up to Ernesto. And God, man, like, just this movie, it keeps creating, like, it keeps bringing up these themes, like, of, like, false admiration and things like that, man. I love that. this movie's so fucking deep for its runtime.
Yeah, it's like not all that glitters is gold kind of thing.
Yeah. But yeah, we get a bit more history, sort of backstory into Ernesto de la Cruz. You know, he's got a cool guitar, a pretty recognizable guitar, which is pretty important to note. But yeah, Remember Me is the song that he's best known for. That comes back. The lyrics of Remember Me, I'm not going to sing it or anything like that, but it's actually really beautiful. It obviously plays into Hector and Coco's sort of story a little bit later. That I believe that song also won an Oscar.
Goddamn.
Yeah. Hold on. Yeah, best achievement. Oh, okay. Yeah, best achievement in music written for motion pictures, original song, for the song Remember Me by Robert Lopez and Kristen Anderson Lopez.
That's pretty cool. I read about that. Yeah, it's like the married couple. It's like one of the first times they'd actually really gotten to like work together on something.
I didn't know about that. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, I think they're actually a married couple, and they're like separate musicians, and they work on different things. I could totally be wrong, and I probably am. But I believe I read this is one of the first things they get to work on together, and they obviously, I mean, they need to work together in the future more, because they just nailed the music of this shit out of the park.
Oh, dude, the music in this movie is incredible. But I mean, like, you've also got the original songs like these, but also the score, I guess, if you want to call it that. The composition is done by Michael Giacchino, who's pretty famous. He did Rogue One and the new Star Trek movies. He works with J.J. Abrams a lot. I'm pretty sure he did Super 8 from memory.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. He's really becoming sort of, I guess, the next Hans Zimmer. You know, he's kind of getting up there. But he's cool, man. He's cool. Yeah. The scene in the plaza with the mariachi.
Yeah, and, I love that. Yeah, if I were you, I'd march right up to my family. He's like such a badass, and then when the grandmother shows up, he's like, like running for his life.
I just love the pulling of the sandal. And slapping with the sandal, dude, that is like a shot from my childhood.
Yeah, just grabbing the closest thing.
Dude, that is literally like my childhood. But just before we go past it, the mariachi does sort of give him his guitar. And, you know, Miguel plays a little bit of it and things like that. And, you know, we find out that there's going to be this sort of this festival, right? This Day of the Dead festival.
Yeah, they're doing like a talent show in the plaza.
Yeah, it's pretty cool, man. But then, yeah, Abuelita fucking breaks that shit up.
Yeah, I love the sister. He's like, oh, there's a talent show and blah, blah, blah. Well, don't you have to have talent first?
Yeah, that's fucking great, man. But this is, I guess, the moment where the family finds out that Miguel doesn't want to go into the shoe shining business.
Yeah, I think, because there's Yeah, basically, he's wanting to play the plaza, but, you know, they're like, tonight is about family. You know, we're not nobody's going anywhere tonight. Like, they're basically, I mean, and I hate seeing this in these kind of movies where it's like, dude, I mean, I get it. There's this like long-standing tradition, but you start really feeling for Miguel because he never gets the chance to like say what he wants to say or kind of stand up for himself, and he just explodes at one point. And it feels so good when he does that, and he kind of just like, no, fuck you. Like, I like that because there's definitely things, like, especially growing up with my family, and whereas, you know, your family's not, my family is about as much Christian as you guys are, you know, Muslim. You know, it's not like it's something that, you know, controls our life to the point where, you know, it's detrimental. But at the same time, you know, I've played in a band, I've been a musician, you know, and it's not something that my parents were like, no, we don't want you doing that. But they wanted me to have a real job and be able to support myself. And they were very weary of playing any kind of music, which, I mean, my older brother Adam and my older brother Austin were all in bands. So I think just them saying no wanted us to do it more. But I totally my family was never anything like Miguel's family, but at the same time, I definitely understand that frustration of someone not being 100% supportive of something that you're doing, especially when it's, you know, I understand strangers or even friends, but your family, you know, it's like, come on, this is something that I'm fully invested in, and I'd hope you'd be right there with me too. So I understand that frustration. I really do. That part of it really spoke out to me.
Right. I can't really sort of sympathize with that. I mean, my parents are fucking amazing. You know, hey, I'm starting a podcast. Oh, that's great. What's it called? Like, you know, but, and I'm just like, hey, don't listen because we say some pretty bad shit.
Yeah, right.
But yeah, we find out a bit more about the ofrenda. We've put, Abu Lita says, we've put their photos in the ofrenda so their spirits can cross over. Which is important because that obviously comes back into it later. But essentially this is kind of a scene where his the dog that he finds.
Dante
breaks the photo frame with Mama Imelda and who he thinks is Ernesto. Well, he thinks it's Ernesto because he fucking flips the thing over, right, and sees the guitar.
Right, yeah. This was actually really good. This reveal, I like, especially with who it actually ends up being. I didn't see this coming. Like, I could definitely tell. It's like, okay, cool. Like, this kid's great-great-grandfather abandoned the family, and then all of a sudden we have this other guy who's like a world-famous musician and from the local area. I was like, that's got to be his grandfather. So they kind of, like, set you up to believe that. But it's
done really well.
Yeah, it's a good reveal later on of who it actually is. It's like, motherfucker.
Yeah, yeah, for sure, man. That twist, goddamn. Every time Coco speaks, Papa is coming home, I fucking start crying.
That's fucking hard, man. That's hard to watch.
Yeah, man. And she's like, no, Mama, it's okay, I'm here. And she's like, who are you? And I was just like, oh my god. Like, you know, this is a fucking kids movie. Are you serious? Are you serious right now? This isn't the scene where we get the broken frame. We actually cut back to, I guess, just another scene of Dante and Coco just chilling by themselves. And Miguel. Miguel's sort of strumming the guitar along with Ernesto on the TV. And a fun little fact, Pixar's sort of animation is so, like, detailed that the actual sort of finger movements on the guitar is the actual sort of notes that a real-life person will be playing.
Yeah, when I was watching it, because I don't play guitar myself. I do play bass. I like playing bass. And I was like, man, that looks pretty realistic if that's not 100% like what it is.
It's pretty fucking beautiful, man. But yeah, you can, I love that they convey the actual, like, the admiration of Miguel. You can see it in his eyes, just how much he admires this Ernesto guy.
Oh yeah.
They bring that across so well, dude. Again, it's fucking crazy. But, basically Miguel sneaks the guitar And oh god, I'm not doing a good job of this, am I? I'm so fucking amazed at this movie. It's one of those movies that I like. Okay, I'm getting like I guarantee you I'm going to be in tears by the end of this podcast because I've seen it again. I love the parents. We have a big surprise for you, and here's an apron. You can go start making shoes.
God, that's awful.
That's rough. Like, I can't imagine. Okay, my dad's a graphic designer. Look, I like computers and I can design shit, but I can't imagine if my dad was like, hey, congratulations, you're going to be a graphic designer. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, that's another thing I can't abide by is, you know, again, it's just your tradition. You're forced into it. It's like, no. Like, I mean, I'd be like, fuck you and fuck that. I'm not doing that shit. Like, I can't stand watching things in movies when people are forced into them or it's just tradition and, you know, don't rock the boat. You know, this is just what we do. Oh, I hate seeing stuff like that.
Yeah. Like, hey man, don't carve your own sense of identity out. Just you know, be what we want you to be, and that's it.
Right?
Like,
yeah.
It's just ugh, I hate it. But this is the scene basically. Dante's eating something on the ofrenda, and Miguel's pulling him away, and the frame breaks, and this is where we get the reveal that it actually might be Ernesto, who is the great great grandfather of Miguel. And obviously Miguel is awesome. He's just fucking like over the moon. He's like, oh my god, my great great grandfather is the most famous musician ever.
Yeah, this would be like me finding out my great 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 grandfather was like Freddie Mercury from Queen. I'd be like, oh my god.
Oh fucking hell, man. Galileo. Anyway. But then we get this scene, like, immediately, like, they find all the sort of the music paraphernalia.
Yeah.
And literally, what is all this? You keep all your secrets from your own family. It's heavy. It's a heavy scene.
Yeah, I wanted to be like, you know, usually when this happens between a kid and their families, it's a lot more shit than a record player and a guitar. Like, it's usually like empty weed baggies and
oh, yeah.
And like a crack bike.
Oh, yeah. Whoa.
Yeah.
Well, where you been, Collin? You wanna sit down on this chair over here and talk about your problems?
Yeah. Collin, are you insinuating that all Mexican 9-year olds smoke crack?
Yes.
Yes.
But yeah, this is essentially at the end of this scene, Abuelita breaks the guitar.
Dude, that's fucked up, man.
Fucking hell, man. She's so passionate. Like, She fully 100% believes that music is bad.
Yeah, I just, man, that and but I loved Miguel's dad even before she smashes it, you know, and he's like, Mama, you know, and like even he's like, come on, dude, like that's enough. You know, you don't need to take it that far. Yeah, that's enough.
Yeah, like that's what I like about these movies, man. Like there's no, I mean, there are some shades of gray. Like you are teaching kids, you know, positives and negatives, but there are sort of shades of gray and things like that. I fucking love that about these movies. Miguel, I don't want to be in this family. And he just runs off. Love that.
Yeah.
Takes a photo. He's crying. He's running off. Basically, he goes to the plaza and he's looking for a guitar because he wants to play in the talent show. He ends up at the mausoleum of Ernesto, breaks into the mausoleum, steals a guitar, strums it, and I love this shot, dude, with the leaves.
Oh, dude, yeah, I think it's some kind of marigold, I think. I was reading up on them a little bit, the one that gets used to the film. But, yeah, it's some kind of marigold flower. I actually Googled what they look like in real life, and they're gorgeous. I mean, they're beautiful flowers. But, yeah, it's a great shot.
Yeah, would you say in a movie like this, would you say that they're shots? Like, I mean, they've been storyboarded, but it's not like they've been filmed with a camera.
Yeah, I still say like just because I mean it's basically the same thing. Like I get it, they're not really on a set, if they're not really sitting down, but you know it's no different me than talking about, you know, when I just say a shot, you know, I don't even know what other word I would use to describe it. Like this, oh yeah, this animated panel, you know, like this thing, you know, this thing, it's you know, it, like we said, it's yeah, it's animated, but it doesn't like take anything away from it. Like I still consider it like, yeah, it's absolutely a shot. It's still directed well. And there's still, if anything, it's probably even like there's pros and cons to everything. And I think doing an animated movie, people automatically assume there's a lot more pros, but I'm telling you, man, there's probably way more cons. Like it's just so difficult to do animated stuff.
Oh, 100%.
Even though these guys are like the kings of it now, but still, I mean, there was, it just, especially with, it'd be different if they were still doing like Shrek level stuff, but you know, compare this to like Shrek, it's like, oh my god, you know, it's like leaps and bounds better.
Yeah, man. Look, hey, Shrek is pretty fucking deep as well.
Yeah, I know that's one. I do fucking love Shrek. I relate to Shrek a lot myself.
Oh, me too, dude. Me too. Fjordar? Anyway, but then we get this. I didn't watch any trailers for this movie going into it. I was like completely blind. I was like, okay, well, I'm just gonna fucking take the shot in the dark and hope that it's good because it's nominated for all these Oscars. I had no idea that this movie was about a kid who enters the afterlife. When this sort of like groundskeeper walks through him, I was like, whoa.
Yeah, that took me through a fucking loop too. I was like, what just happened?
Mm, yeah. But he walks out and he's basically glowing and he sees his parents looking for him and he goes to hug him, walks straight through him, enters in, like just falls into a grave. And he discovers his family, his dead family. This could be so dark.
Oh,
this could be like Stephen King level dark if you could like if you made it a different way.
Yeah, imagine if Pixar made it an R-rated movie. Like, holy shit, that would be awesome.
And that's what I'm saying, man. I think it's easier to make it dark, and it's a really tough challenge to make a movie like this that talks about, you know, your dead ancestors as skeletons, as skeletal remains, accessible to kids. Like, I think that's such a higher hurdle to jump. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like, one of the things I absolutely love is when he's running and he's chasing Dante and he knocks into that guy and totally disassembles him. And it ends up being his Papa Julio, I think. I guess it's like his great-grandfather or his grandfather. But what's hilarious, he knocks him down, and I love as he's pulling the pieces of him back together, he just starts reassimilating himself, like fucking Dr. Manhattan style. Like, it's like, dude, that's cool. Like, I like the way the skeletons can, like, just pull themselves back together again. But as soon as he does, one of his aunts comes running over and smacks him back down into pieces. I was like, okay, that's actually really fucking funny. I like that.
That's good shit, man. But, yeah, he discovers that it's his family. Well, his dead family. And, we get told from the twins that Mama Imelda can't cross over, and it's pretty like, again, layers to this movie, because like, okay, why can't she cross over? What are they even talking about for one? Crossover from the other side? Like, this movie got so much deeper.
Like, yeah, they kind of throw you in the deep end, and they're just like, swim, motherfucker.
Yeah, at this point, my dad was like, what is happening?
Yeah.
Like, what's happening? And like I fully had to, like, explain to him, like, okay, so everyone he sees here is dead, and literally they're about to cross over a bridge, and the bridge is the other side.
Yeah, what do you think about the City of the Dead? What do you think about the other side and the way it looks?
It looks cool. It looks pretty unique. It's really colorful. Animation-wise, it looks fucking beautiful, but it doesn't really make sense. I mean, like, is everyone dead there from their own culture? I mean, like, I don't... Is it, like, a Mexican-only thing? Like, I don't... you know what I mean?
I guess so, yeah. That's kind of what I took away from it. I guess it's just, you know, it's like with Nordic people, you have like Valhalla, you know, and it's like, it's not like you're going to bump into a Mexican skeleton in Valhalla. You know, it's like, I guess just they're doing their own kind of you know, it's just their tradition. It's their people's tradition. It's what they consider to be, you know, their afterlife and stuff. But the one thing that kind of threw me off is this city. Did you ever play the BioShock games?
I did. This is remind you of Infinite.
Yeah, it reminded me of Infinite and like a little bit of the first game, just everything like really, really close Rapture. Together. Yeah, Rapture. Yeah. It reminded me a lot of like Night Before Christmas meets BioShock. I was like, okay, this is fucking cool, man. Like, I love that game. I love that movie. I can get behind this. Like, this is really cool.
It's fucking awesome, man. Like, it's really, really creative, just the way they've done it. Apparently, this movie was in development for years.
Yeah.
Since 2011.
Yeah, dude, that's like, oh, my God. And especially, the way that those marigolds look, the flowers, just the whole bridge. And, like, mm-hmm. oh, my God, that looks incredible, man. I love that.
Of course.
Yeah. I do like the one guy who comes back in. I think he's the dentist. You know, he's got like the braces on and stuff. I might have read this wrong. I believe that's John Ratzenberger.
Yes, it is.
Cool. Yeah, they consider him their good luck charm, quote unquote.
Yes, so they absolutely. Put him in. He's in almost every Pixar movie, if not every, I think.
Yeah, I was like, dude, that's fucking hilarious. That's awesome.
Mm. Absolutely. Just before that, though, we get introduced to what's called alebrijes. Alebrijes. It's the spirit animals. I'm just going to refer to them as spirit animals from here on out.
Alebrijes.
How do I do that in an Australian accent? Alebrijes. Nah, mate. Nah. Fucking hell. But yeah, spirit creatures. This is something that's probably inherently Mexican.
Yeah, this shit kind of threw me through a loop when I first saw it. I was like, oh, all right, what the fuck is that? Like, just from the coloring of them and the way that they look, I was like, okay, what the hell is that? Like, it took me out of it for like 2 seconds, but I was like, okay, you know what? I've come this far with you. I'll go with that. I'll agree that you've got some kind of like mythical Pegasus or something like that. Like, fuck it, I'll go there with you.
See, I think because it's based in culture. I'm 100% on board with it because it's already pre-established. It's not like them. I don't think they're making it up for the movie. I think this is an actual sort of belief, right?
Yeah.
But then we get, I do love the creativity of the costumes, like how they literally have to check their faces and, you know, oh, your son has put your photos on the ofrenda. So you're being remembered so you can cross over. Like, dude, that's cool.
Yeah, I do like that. That's pretty cool. Again, we're establishing rules early on. You know, we're establishing, you know, how you have to, like, even if you were to make it past security, you can't even crash. You couldn't even cross the bridge like we see.
Right, as we see with Hector.
Yeah, right. I'm like, oh, that's really cool. So, yeah, again, I like movies where there are like some kind of rules established and we stick to those and they end up being the things that kind of get our story tangled up and raise our stakes later on. So I like that a lot.
For sure. Well, we meet Hector, a.k.a. Frida Kahlo.
Yeah, right. As soon as I saw it, I was like, oh, shit, Frida Kahlo.
Yeah, yeah. But that doesn't really fly. No one's put his photo up on the ofrenda.
It's
so
sad.
Essentially he's not able to sort of go over and cross the other side, but he makes a break for it anyway, ends up wading through the marigold leaves, and it's a pretty, I thought it was a pretty sad moment.
Yeah, like, I was like, just him
feel pretty bad
falling into the bridge, like just disappearing. I was like, because at first I thought he was kind of going to be just like a random throwaway character. I was like, okay, this guy's just going to run across the bridge and he'll disappear into the bridge and that'll be it. And I'm like, oh shit, like, wow, that's kind of dark, you know. And I was like, oh wait, no, that's not the case, never mind.
The way they shoot it as well, like you see the camera kind of like come from behind him and then like he's just kind of really literally like swimming in the leaves.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. He's like, yeah, he's literally up to his like chin and fucking those marigolds. Like, holy fuck, that's kind of crazy.
It's sad, man. But we see more of the city. Miguel's family literally has to declare him like customs, like quarantine. We have a live person.
Yeah, it's kind of like the child getting out in Monsters, Inc.
Yes, literally what I was thinking, man. Boo.
Yeah.
we meet Mama Imelda. She's arguing, and she's like, she's literally, this is... I can't believe how creative this is. Like the you see a shot of like this these couples. We are not visiting your ex-wife's family. It's so fucking funny, man. Like, this just seems like jokes for adults as well. What do you think of Mama Imelda?
I think she's a good character. I think that there is something, you know, she's obviously like the top tier, like matriarch of the family. She's literally the one who, you know, held this family together and started having everyone make shoes. So there is like a huge amount of like respect, like for her. But at the same time, there is just that kind of like, you have to do what I say and not question it and not do anything else. And it's like, man, it makes you just want to question it and do something else even more. You know, it's just like, oh God, like this, like she's wants what's best, but ultimately like a lot of parents, you know, they end up kind of like self-sabotaging to the point where they're, you know, they're making ultimatums and they're dealing in absolutes and, you know, no, you can never do this. And ultimately it's just not fair to the person involved with it. And so I kind of disliked her character from the get go. It's like, all right, she's just kind of like the buzzkill, like kind of bitch. But at the same time, it's just like, you know, they just don't want that kind of life for Miguel. And I understand that, but you know, that's kind of something that needs to be his choice. So like right off the bat, I was just kind of like, man, I don't like this fucking woman, but you like, I think they do a good job of as the movie goes on, kind of making her a little bit more appealing and kind of you warm up to her a little bit more.
For sure. Yeah, I definitely had the same thing with as you did. Definitely 100%. We find out that Miguel is cursed for stealing the guitar. And this is basically where we find out. Well, Mama Mel, she's like, music. She literally like, this is where it comes from, right? The whole hatred of music.
Right, yeah.
Mm-hmm. We find out, well, Imelda's pissed that Miguel took the photo off the ofrenda, shit like that. You know, shit just kind of ensues. But basically, the thing here is Miguel needs his family's blessings in order to return to the land of the living by sunrise. And immediately right there, that's where you create the stakes, right?
Right, yeah, we're setting up rules. We have a time limit. The window's closing. Our stakes go up.
Mm-hmm. And love the shot of his finger going sort of skeletal. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, for sure. That's kind of actually another thing from the Halloween tree. There's a little boy they're trying to catch who's in he's basically dead. And he's like a spectral kind of thing. And the longer he stays out, the longer he stays dead, the harder it's going to be to like bring him back into life. It's like, oh, okay, cool. This is like, it's actually got a lot in common with one of my favorite movies. So it helped me get through it, even though it was not my kind of movie. I could kind of relate to it from another. If you've never seen it, watch the Halloween tree. It's fucking really good.
Yeah, I'm writing it down as we speak, actually. Imelda, I give you my blessing to go home, to put my photo back on the ofrenda, and to never play music again. And obviously Miguel's pissed, right?
Right. Yeah.
She can add any condition she wants.
Yeah.
He takes the pedal, goes back to the land of the living. I was not expecting this. I was like, oh, okay, he's back already. But immediately, he literally does what he breaks the rules.
Yeah, right. And like, literally, what did she say? She's like, 2 minutes. 2 minutes is all it took.
Yeah, 2 minutes. It's all it took. And she basically, Miguel's just like, you hate music that much? Well, fuck you.
Yeah.
Like, I'm just going to go and get Ernesto's blessing because he's family.
Right, yeah.
Which is clever, I thought.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. I didn't see that coming. I was like, oh, okay. So this is like, again, like, but it's going to be hard to reach him. We don't know how, you know, they've never met before, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, okay, this is kind of cool. We're going to make an adventure out of this. I see where our plot's going now.
Yeah. Well, not to mention we're like half an hour into the movie. Like, I mean, this is, although like we've got so much info, and we're literally kind of beginning the main sort of plot right now, aren't we?
Right, yeah. This is kind of where we're, again, and we're, you know, like we're not, I think we're maybe like 20 or 30 minutes in. You know, we've got like our plot set up. We've got, you know,
me too, yeah.
You know, because there's a lot of family on both sides, the living and the dead. And there, you know, we see his older siblings. We see his twin uncles. You know, they're all very distinctive and have different personalities. So it's easy to like tell them apart. I mean, obviously, besides being living and dead, but they're not really just kind of like, oh, and I'm here too, you know, kind of thing. Like his family members are all kind of distinctive.
100%, man. But we meet with Hector. He's talking to a security guard. He's like, you get me across the bridge tonight, and I'll make you famous because I know Ernesto de la Cruz. And Miguel overhears him, and he's like, oh, okay, I can use this guy. I like the shit that he does with his hands. Like the sort of skeleton play.
Yeah, I like that a lot. The way that they're able, even like in their choreography, to keep their heads straight and their bodies spinning. I love that kind of stuff. I think it looks fantastic.
It's cool. And it's not like overly sort of frightening, right? Like, because you got to think about kids. Right. Like, it strikes a really cool balance.
Bunch of pussies.
A bunch of fucking pussies. I love his eyeballs going into his mouth.
Yeah, I was like, oh, shit, that reminds me of like some Beetlejuice shit. Oh, never mind. You've never seen Beetlejuice. Fuck you.
No, I haven't. No, I haven't.
Oh, my God.
Miguel and Hector strike up a...
You're fired.
Strike up a relationship, and, they can each sort of help each other. Miguel, if you help me, then you can put my photo on the ofrenda, and I can visit. And this is basically... kind of turns into a chase movie a little bit.
Yeah, right. You've got Miguel and Hector heading towards, they've got their own kind of wants and needs and desires, and they have their own kind of thing going on. But at the same time, we've got Miguel's family right behind him, which, Hector is kind of sketchy, like he's that soul patch wearing motherfucker and his legs all wobbly.
Is this guy a pedo?
Yeah, like he looks kind of rough, man. It's like I don't trust him right off the bat.
We made Pepita. Mama Imelda's awesome fucking spirit animal. This is a griffin?
Yeah.
That's fucking sick. I love it. I love the colors, man. The colors are beautiful.
Yeah, that's the only thing that kind of threw me off like at first. It's like, what the hell is that thing? And I was like, oh, okay, like I can get behind that. That's cool. Like as I was watching it, Lindsay's brother and I were watching it, and we were all like making like Harry Potter and like Neverending Story references and shit.
That's cool. That's cool. Hector dresses Miguel up in whiteface, racist.
I'm offended.
You should be offended, because your people have been down for hundreds of years, haven't they?
Yeah, very oppressed.
But yeah, obviously he gives him makeup just to sort of blend in. And, this is where we get the agreement. You get me to my grandpa, I'll put your photo up, and then I can cross the bridge. I was like you, I think. Did you like Hector as a character to begin with? Because I didn't like him as a character. Well, to start. And then I was like, oh, shit, this guy's awesome.
Yeah, especially after you hear him start playing guitar and stuff, he kind of grows on you. There's a lot of that. There's a lot of these characters that start off kind of sketchy and we don't really know about him, but over the course of time it kind of we kind of warm up to them just because they reveal things about them that they kind of that they wouldn't reveal normally, and they kind of show a side of them to Miguel just to not to ease him, but it just ends up kind of, that's kind of just a small effect of it. But at the same time, it's usually something like, Hector has to play the guitar for Cheech. Cheech just wants, one last song. Miguel just happens to be there to see it. As Miguel's trying to run off later, and his great-grandmother, what is his great-grandmother's name? I'm sorry. I can't, I there's so many different names in this. The one that's after him.
Imelda.
And, she reveals that she can sing, but that's obviously it's just for things that they need, And I was like, oh, okay, cool. It's not like they're just showing Miguel this for like no reason. I like that they do this with these characters so we can feel a little bit closer to them and relate to them a little more.
Yeah, man. I fully 100% agree. Like, I'm not even going to try and say anything better because that was fucking awesome.
Thank you.
They break into this rehearsal space, I guess. Miguel sees this model just kind of like modeling in the nude, I guess.
Yeah, right.
I was like, oh, all right. Paint me like, draw me like one of your French girls.
Yeah.
This might be the weakest part of the movie for me. I didn't really dig this part with the rehearsal sort of. What do you think?
I don't know. I kind of liked it, man. I liked it.
Yeah.
Well, like a lot of these movies are just people falling ass backwards into plot devices. You know, like he falls ass backwards into Ernesto, or I'm sorry, not Ernesto, Hector.
Hector, yeah.
Hector and Miguel wind up, you know, meeting up with Frida Kahlo, and they fall ass backwards into this band that tells them, you know, where his show's going to be. Like, it's all very, oh, I'm glad that happened. You know, that's just like kind of the way that it is, but I don't mind it because, you know, here we are. Oh, yeah, we're just going to show up and he's going to be right there at the rehearsal. And it's like, wah, wah, like he's not there. We know that our story needs to keep moving on further and keep going.
Yeah, okay, I'm with you.
But at the same time, I can understand like why this seems like kind of weak, just in terms of like, okay, now it seems like we're putting up hurdles.
It's just a detour.
Right. We're just putting up hurdles just to put up hurdles at some points. It's like, okay, dude, don't get me wrong. It's an hour and 45 minute long movie. I'm not saying we need to start cutting stuff, but you could cut like one or two things, you know, nothing big, you know, just kind of small things. I think they could leave out. I see your point.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. One thing that's really actually important here, we find out, it's pretty dark to say, but Hector's cause of death, he choked on some chorizo.
Yeah, chorizo, like Mexican sausage.
Yeah, I love chorizo. But yeah, he choked on it. And I was like, oh, that's a...
Okay, fucking I guess, lame.
You know. But he got food poisoning, actually, is Hector's sort of correction. Which is what he thinks, dude, which is fucking dark, actually. When you think about it, like this guy died and he's still like in death, thinks that he died by food poisoning. God damn.
Yeah. And he's been dead for like 7 decades, probably like seven or eight decades. It's in the 40s, shit.
Yeah. Good Lord, man. We move on. It's great. Great commentary right here, right? we cut back to the family. Basically, Pepita, the spirit animal's following his footsteps. I love the way the footsteps kind of like illuminate.
Yeah, it's cool. I fucking love that. That looks cool. That reminds me of some Arkham Knight shit, like with detective mode on.
Oh, dude, when you're looking for what's his name? Deadshot? No.
Yeah.
I think it might be Arkham City. But anyway. Side tangent. We come to this sort of shanty town. Basically, this is a town where no one's photos are on any sort of living family members or friends, right? This is kind of like forgotten people.
This is fucking sad, man.
This is sad as shit. But you know, they don't really care. Like, they're all like kind of sitting in front of their front porches and shit like that, like having a good time. And I was just like, oh, wow, okay. This is another good thing about this movie, man. Like, it doesn't, like I said, it doesn't paint everything in black and white. Sometimes it's shades of gray. Like, this could be the most gloomiest thing that you've seen in your life, but these people are all forgotten, yet they're still sort of, they're enjoying themselves still. Unless you're Cheech in the hammock, then, you know.
Yeah. I think they all kind of accept it as well, too, because at some point, you know, somewhere down the line, someone's not going to put your picture on the ofrenda. Like, eventually, I mean, if it's 300 or 400 years or however long down the line, you know, eventually someone's not going to put that picture up and you are going to be forgotten about. Like, it's just going to happen. And I think that's kind of interesting because I think Hector even says that once Cheech disappears, he's like, you know, well, what are you going to do, man? It happens to all of us, you know, blah, blah, blah. And he kind of like brushes it off and we kind of see why, because we don't, unbeknownst to us, but Hector's going through this right now and he's starting to be like completely forgotten about, which is why he's so urgent to get back to the other side. But mm-hmm, I think it's great because like it's, you know, we're already dealing with something like death, but now we're dealing with like final death. You're not coming back from this. Like, this is not some kind of like all dogs go to heaven, like bullshit for, you know, where have you ever seen that movie? The early Disney animated movie?
No.
It's like literally it's called All Dogs Go to Heaven. And it's like no matter what the dog was like, they all go to heaven. They're all real nice. And that's what kind of the problem that I've always had with Disney movies is even when you're dead, there's like a society of like the dead people and stuff like that. So it took me out of this movie kind of took me out of it at first. It's like, God, even when you're dead, it looks fun. And then they're like, no, like there's final death. And I was like, oh, OK, like, OK, OK, you have my curiosity. Now you have my attention.
Now you have my attention.
Right. And I was like, that's cool. And I love the way that Hector kind of plays Cheech out, and Cheech is, you know, he's just I think a lot of these people just kind of accept it. You know, it's just going to happen. Like I said, it's going to happen someday. And it's not like Cheech dies this like violent, awful death. He takes his hat off.
Disappears.
Yeah. He just literally takes his hat off and just like rests and just let it happen. And it's like, wow, I like to think that this might have just been like, you know, when he disappears, you know, Miguel's like, what happened? He's like, Thanos has the Infinity Gauntlet.
I love the way the hammock just kind of like, because there's less weight on it, it just slumps up.
Yeah, and Hector taking the fucking shot at tequila, and also obviously him playing the song and revealing that he's a pretty spectacular musician.
Dude, he's fucking great. Well, everyone remembers Juanita. Her eyes each a different color. But I love that he changes the lyrics because Miguel's there.
Yeah, those aren't words; they're children present.
Oh man, this was probably the first scene where I was close to waterworks. They do such a good job of like immediately making you feel like there's something heavy here.
Right, for sure. Like, we're also kind of establishing the rule, you know, because Miguel's asking Hector, you know, but where did he go? You know, blah, blah, blah. You know, he says somebody forgot about him. But, you know, but I remember I can go back and put his picture up. He says it doesn't work like that. Our memories have to be passed down by those who knew us in life and the stories they tell about us. So we're establishing a rule that like you can't just run back and start picking people up like that. You know, it kind of has to be linked to you in a certain way. You can't go in there and start saving everybody.
That's right, man. That's fucking cool. Did you ever watch Inside Out?
No.
So Inside Out was pretty clever. I mean, just quickly before I run off on a massive tangent, it's basically about the emotions in this girl's head. And like you see the emotion, like the emotions are characterized as like kind of like people, right? And there's like a kind of like this abyss, like this kind of like pit that you don't see the bottom of. And basically anything that falls into that pit is forgotten, like it's forgotten memories. It's fucking cool. And it kind of reminded me of this, because forgotten, like, you know, once something goes into the pit of forgotten memories, it doesn't come back. I love that.
Yeah, that's cool.
But yeah, Cheech Marin. Love that it's Cheech.
Yeah, they have a couple of people on here. They have Gabriel Iglesias. If you've ever seen any of his stand up, he's not.
Yeah,
I don't personally. Guy, right? Yeah, I'm not Vlad. I'm Fuffy. You know, I don't personally like his stand up very much, but he is a pretty fucking talented guy. He's a good voice actor as well. He's in this for a couple of bits.
No, I did say that he is in this. I'm not too familiar with him though, so I was like, "Yeah, okay." But yeah, this was probably our first heavy scene, right? Learn about the final death, memories have to be passed down, blah blah blah. Blah blah blah. Like it's nothing.
Yeah.
But they move on because they want to get to the contest, to get to Ernesto's palace or party or whatever, because whoever wins the contest gets to play for Ernesto. And dude, what do you think of this tram kind of thing that goes through the air in the village?
Oh, you mean like, wait, what do you call it?
It's kind of like a tram, like a floating tram or tram car.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Again, another thing that absolutely reminded me of Bioshock. More so like Bioshock Infinity, where you're flying around with the hook and you can pull into like those cable car kind of things. Yeah, it definitely reminded me of that, which I mean, I don't have a problem with. But I liked it. I thought it was pretty cool. It reminded me of a couple of different things, kind of like some actually the Call of Duty Black Ops 3 Zombies, there's a map called Shadows of Evil that looks a lot like this town, and there's like a cable car above head, and you can just shoot zombies from it the whole time. Yeah, that's kind of what that reminds me of.
Oh, for sure. But I do like sort of the dialogue that you get between Hector and Miguel, like throughout the movie. Basically, whenever Miguel talks up Ernesto, and like Miguel's like, he's the greatest musician of all time. And Hector's like, oh, you're funny, greatest eyebrows of all time, maybe. And then like, Miguel's just like, you don't know what you're talking about. Like, it's that kind of like young, I want to believe that this person is great kind of thing.
Right, like don't meet your heroes kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah. Like, don't meet your heroes because you'd be fucking disappointed. Fucking love that. But they get to Plaza de la Cruz. And basically, Miguel wants to play Remember Me, but you find out that everyone wants to play Remember Me.
Right, yeah. It's like, cool. Of course everybody wants to play this awesome song.
Yeah, I mean, like, it's the most famous, right? But I do like the song that they go with. It's pretty fucking catchy.
Well, especially so many people were playing the song given the night that, I mean, it's kind of the theme of the whole thing. Remember me. Don't forget about me. Because if you do, I'm dead. You know, it's kind of like, don't forget about me kind of thing. Don't you forget about me.
Oh, boy. We just got some pipes, ladies and gentlemen. You're going to have to pay for this episode now.
Next episode is Breakfast Club. No, I'm just kidding.
Oh, boy. Before we get to the actual sort of contest, do you want to maybe take a break around here?
Yeah, that's fine with me.
Fucking awesome. Guys, we'll be right back. Stick with us. We are just going to go refill our coffee, take a piss, and we'll be right back.
It's you.
You're going to get me in trouble,
Dante. Someone could hear me.
I wish someone wanted to hear me. Other than you.
I know I'm not supposed to love music.
No music. No music.
But my great-grandma Coco's father was the greatest musician of all time.
Papa.
Ernesto de la Cruz.
One day, he left with his guitar and never returned.
No, my family thinks music is a curse.
Great-great-grandfather, none of them understand me.
I'm supposed to play music.
All right, who's in there?
I'm sorry. What's going on?
I'm just dreaming.
Do you mind?
Welcome to the land of the dead.
Dante, wait up! You gotta stay with me, boy.
This isn't a dream, then. You're all really out there.
Agents at the Department of Family Reunions are available to assist you.
Please be on the lookout for a living boy.
Miguel? You're here.
We're your family, mijo.
I know your great-great-grandpa. I'll get you to him.
What are you doing?
I'm walking like a skeleton.
No, skeletons don't walk like that.
It's how you walk.
No, I don't. When there's no one left in the living world who remembers you, you disappear from this world.
But you can change that.
We gotta find my great-great-grandpa.
You gotta do it by sunrise.
What happens at sunrise?
You'll be stuck here forever.
What?
Ugh. I'm a big fan.
Never forget how much your family loves you.
It's almost sunrise.
One cannot deny who one is meant to be.
It's you! I am terribly allergic.
But Dante doesn't have any hair.
And I don't have a nose, and yet here we are. It's you!
Hey guys, welcome back. We just relieved ourselves, I guess, if that's how you want to put it, Colin.
Yeah, I was actually doing it during the movie, but that's fine to take a break.
Oh, awesome, awesome. I hope, yeah, well, you just changed your pee bag, I guess. We were at the festival. Basically, Coco. God, I keep going to call him Coco.
Yeah, but dude, it kind of fucked me up, too, because it's like your title character, but she's only in the movie for like 5 minutes.
But I mean, I guess she's one of the most important parts of the movie. Like,
right, it's, yeah.
You know, like, I don't know. But basically, Miguel is about to perform. At first, he's nervous, but he gets into it. You know, Hector kind of pushes him into it. I dig the song that they play here. I'm gonna play a little bit, actually.
Yeah, do
just
it.
Hopefully we don't get put into copyright, but I don't give a shit. I fucking dig it, man.
Yeah, I love it, man. I honestly do. I speak like beginner's level Spanish. You know, I can't like speak a whole lot of it or talk like fluently, but you know, yo estudio mucho español en escuela, you know, like I actually speak like beginner Spanish a little bit, but there's just something I love about their language. It's got this like great crackly kind of energy to it.
And it's graceful.
Yeah. And it's
so melodic.
Right. It's like versus something like French or something like that, which is very kind of relaxed and more throaty, kind of meal, you know, kind of like sound to it, where you have like, you know, you have Spanish and it's very like up, you know, it's always kind of, they always talk on like this upbeat kind of like kind of speech. And I love that. It has this great energy. It's very energetic kind of language. And I like, you know, being able to, you know, rojo, like roll your R's and stuff. I love that. I did Duolingo. I did Duolingo for a long time, and I took 2 years of Spanish in high school. Because we actually, you know, here in the South, we do have a large like demographic of Hispanics, and it's great because like there were so many people in my high school that were taking French, and I was like, oh yeah, because we have such a large demographic of the French population here, in the middle of Nashville, and it's just a quick story actually. A grocery store I worked in, there's a little boy, and he actually got lost. He got separated from his mom, and he spoke no English whatsoever. And they wound up, I was like 18, they wound up calling me to the front because they're like, hey, there's nobody here that knows how to speak any Spanish. I was like, I don't know how to speak Spanish. I took like high school Spanish, but I just like knew enough to like talk to the kid and be like, hey, like, what's your name? Like, where's your mom? And blah, blah, blah. And his mom came in like 2 minutes later. She was just outside on a payphone. And I was like, oh, thank God. I was like, Jesus, I didn't like, I was like,
thank God I didn't have to deal with that shit.
a screaming kid, a crying like 5 or 6 year old who doesn't even speak the same language as you. I was like, oh my God. I'd rather disarm a bomb naked and blindfolded, dude. Like, I don't fucking want to deal with this right now. But thankfully, man, just like I said, I'm glad I took those 2 years of Spanish. Cause like you hear people call you like fucking gringo and shit like that, like gordo. And I'm like, hey, I know you're calling me a fat white asshole. You know, like I know what you're calling me. So it's kind of funny to like pick up on shit that like people would call you and suspect that you not speak Spanish. It's like, hey, motherfucker. Like, I know what you said.
Oh, for sure, dude. Like I did. See, you did Spanish. I did Italian. In high school, and actually, a lot of it has stuck with me. I used to go to a Catholic school in high school. Like we used to say the prayers. In Italian. Like I can still like fucking remember it. Like Our Father, you know, Our Father who art in heaven. Do you want me to? Fucking
hit
go into
with,
a little
hit,
bit.
Hit me with it.
All right, all right. Let's fucking do this. Padre nostro, che sei nei cieli, sia santificato il tuo nome, venga il tuo regno, sia santificato. That's all I know. That's all I remember.
Hey, that's pretty good. That's really odd because I've never heard you speak anything else but English. And I was like, wow, that's actually kind of crazy.
But like, it's not only that. Like, it just kind of sticks with you a little bit. Like, I mean, that was back in year seven, dude, seventh grade.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I mean, I remember bits of Hail Mary, like Ave Maria, piena di grazia, il Signore è con te. Tu sei benedetta fra le donne e benedetto sia il frutto del tuo seno Gesù. Santa Maria, Madre di Dio, pregna e pia nome peccatore, I think. Fucking, I can't remember. Amen.
He's speaking, like, he's speaking in tongues. Get the holy water.
Yeah, get the holy water. Fucking hold him down, exorcism style.
I do. I fucking love other languages, though, and that's another reason why I was into this movie. And I was like, okay, I actually do speak like a hair of Spanish. Like, I would never say that I speak Spanish, but just like very beginner Spanish. And I was like, oh, okay. Like, there's little things like here or there that I picked up on, and I was like, oh, like I actually could, like, because I had the captions on. I was like, oh, I can actually understand like a little bit of this, because I can't hear it and pick it up on it super well, but I can read it and be like, oh, okay, I think I know what that means.
That's fucking cool, man. I dig it. But yeah, basically after their performance, well, during the performance, rather, we see Miguel's family looking for him, kind of asking questions. Have you seen a kid wearing wearing this? Blah blah. But after the show, it's Hector finds out that he's on the run. He's on the run from his family.
Mm-hmm. I love they're looking for a living human boy, and it's just like, oh no, nobody's seen him because he's fucking right there on stage the whole time. Yeah. They're asking about him.
He's literally like right there. But this puts a spanner into the works for Hector. He's like, you lied to me, and they get into this massive argument. He's like, I'm being forgotten. I don't even know if I'm going to last the night. I'm not going to miss my one chance to cross that bridge because you want to live out some stupid musical fantasy. And Hector wants to take him to his family, but Miguel just wants to. He's like, you don't want to help me. You only care about yourself. And he runs off. He runs off. Goes and seeks out Ernesto.
Yeah, like, oh man, I can understand getting into the fight with Hector, but then when Dante's trying to pull him back and he's like, you're just a stupid dog, you're not even a spirit animal, I was like, all right, that's fucking low, dude. Like that's you back up. Like, again, I'm I just got a dog like 3 or 4 weeks ago, so I'm kind of like, oh, like super sensitive to that now. I'm like, fuck you, kid. Talk to your dog that way. Literally followed you into another fucking ether of existence, you asshole.
I did wish they made Dante look a little less retarded.
Yeah, he does kind of look. He looks like almost like Lion King hyena-ish. He's like that derpy kind of one with his tongue hanging out.
Like, I get that he's a street dog, but I mean, they didn't have to make him so retarded looking, I guess.
Yeah, right. He has no hair, and he's always like got the tongue hanging out of his mouth and stuff. He's cute though. He's funny.
He is cute, but that's a minor gripe. He gets cornered by Imelda's spirit animal, and then he gets cornered by Imelda herself. And this is a cool moment when they're between the gate and she starts singing. She's got a great voice.
Yeah, right. That's what I was talking about earlier. I love that, we kind of warm up to these characters a little bit more once they kind of let details about them be known. This is something that, he's never even known about this woman. They just heard about like his entire life and never knew that she had this beautiful voice that's just as good as like Hector's, guitar playing. I was like, oh my God, that was a cool, a little revelation. I wasn't expecting that when she starts singing to him. I'm like, that's cool. She's not like screaming at him and forcing him to trying to do something. She's just like, she's kind of trying to compel to his musician's side. I'm like, okay, cool. Yeah. I like that. That's pretty cool.
Well, one thing about Pixar that they don't do often, but I mean, look, they do fall into it sometimes. They don't really do one-dimensional characters. Like their characters are almost always fleshed out, which I really like. I like that she kind of gives his story here. Like, he wanted to play for the world. We each made a sacrifice to get what we wanted. Like, you get this really, really cool backstory into her. And she basically just forces Miguel. She's like, you're going to have to choose now. You literally have to make a choice. Either choose music or choose family.
Right, and I only a Sith deals in absolutes, and I never believe in that. And he even says, I don't want to pick sides, and he shouldn't have to. I hate that part of it where it's just like it's always somebody, it's all or nothing, and it's like it's never all or nothing. It's never black or white. It's like you said earlier, it's going to be shades of gray.
Compromise. Right, this is where you can make the compromise. Like, if you want to follow music, then you got to make some compromises. I love it. But he gets to Ernesto's fucking palace, dude. This thing looks awesome.
Oh, God, yeah. Again, some straight-up Bioshock vibes.
Straight-up Bioshock, but just awesome, awesome creativity from Pixar right here, man. I love this bouncer who just hands him his, skull and takes a photo with it.
Yeah, it does, a skeleton selfie.
Skelfie?
Just Skelfie.
kill me. But basically Miguel's like, hey, I'm an SS Gregor grandson, let me in. And he's like, nope, nah, I'm just gonna throw you out.
He kind of looks like a reject member of the rock band Kiss. Like he kind of looks like someone out of Kiss a little bit,
but he doesn't have the tongue action.
Yeah, right. Thank God.
But yeah,
that'd be really creepy.
Oh, good Lord, like Venom. He sneaks aboard inside the tuba, of the Los Chachalacos. Fucking hell. Not even going to try that. And he managed to get in. And he's absolutely bewildered because this place looks like fucking... It looks like the Disney castle.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
It's crazy. It's crazy, man. But, like, I don't, we didn't really talk about the this movie with its use of colors. Like, you know, you do get a lot of animated movies that use their colors really well, but I think this is the first... Not the first time, but, I mean, like, this is the movie where... colors kind of really stuck out to me. Like, there is, like, almost every color imaginable in this movie.
Right, yeah, kind of had that, like, this might be a weird comparison, but the way Batman Forever kind of feels with that, with the weird neon-y kind of, like, stuff that's terrible in that. But in this, it's great. There's really good uses of, there's really good uses of, like, pink a lot, pink and green. I mean, just looking at the spirit animals, you're like, holy shit. But what's great is they're not sticking to just, like, a regular kind of color palette. It's this great kind of, like, offset neon bright kind of color, which is really cool. And this kind of reminds me of, in another weird way, of like The Great Gatsby, just this guy holding this, like, everything's kind of like, I don't know, kind of older-ish. You know, all of these people who are here are probably from, you know, the 40s and the 50s and the 60s. We've got kind of an older vibe and this, like, really popular guy putting on a party to everybody. Like, it kind of gave me a little bit of a Gatsby vibe.
Yeah, now that you mention it, I'm fucking definitely seeing that. Miguel has a hard time getting Ernesto's attention, but he eventually does by playing a song, and he falls into the pool. Ernesto rescues him, and then he recognizes him. He's like, "You're that boy. You're the one that everyone's looking for, the living one," and because his makeup washes off. And again, man, when they both come out of the water, dude, it looks fucking awesome.
Yeah, that water. God, it looks so good, man.
It's like real water. Like, everything else in this movie is, like, animated, but they, like, actually pictured water.
Yeah, like, God, I wish real water looked as good as it fucking does in this movie.
But Ernesto's likable, dude, at first.
Yeah, he kind of... I don't know if you've ever seen The Rocketeer or not.
Ages ago.
Yeah, he kind of reminds me of Timothy Dalton's character in that, Neville Sinclair. Like, this kind of, like, likable on the surface, but when you really start digging in and seeing, like, what he's like, you know, he's a fucking, you know, a fraud. He's a fraud. Yeah, yeah. He's totally full of shit.
See, he reminds me actually a bit more about of Gilderoy Lockhart from Harry Potter. Did you? I don't know. Like, I mean, like, Gilderoy is not fully likable, though. Like, all the characters in the movie like him at the start, but like he's like slowly revealed to be a fraud, which is cool. Like, that kind of like illusion.
Yeah, that like shine it. Starts to wear off.
Yeah, yeah. But you see, basically, I feel like I just said yeah, yeah, like Arnold. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Dylan. Anyway, yeah. Oh, we got to cover an Arnie movie one day, dude.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
But basically Miguel and Ernesto bonding, right? Like, hey, but this is like false family. This isn't what family feels like. This is going to be like, this is just illusion. It's all illusion. You see Hector on his way up posing once again as Frida Kahlo.
Right, yeah. Like in this whole thing about you know, just kind of, you know, don't meet your heroes, like, really, like, unless, like, if you, like, he's kind of put them so far up on a pedestal that anything that Ernesto would have done that would have been contrary to that, you know, would have brought him down so far. I think it's kind of a good lesson too, you know, don't put all of your stock in people who are like entertainers and stuff. Like, don't like put all your eggs in that basket.
Yeah, 100%, man. Like, this scene, especially, like, when... I think the first sign is basically when, like, he's walking through this room and it's, like, all these offerings and it's just, like, all these rows of guitars and food and shit.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, oh, man, like, this... I can't see this guy being a good guy. Like, you know?
Yeah, it's too good to be true.
Yeah, like, too good to be true. Like, one of those kinds of things. But then we get this scene. This scene where, basically... You know, we find the truth. This scene was heavy. This scene was like, whoa,
Yeah, that like this is one of those things that really kind of put me through a loop. Like when I saw it, I was like, wow, I was not expecting it to go into like, it's not like premeditated murder, but I mean, it kind of is. I mean, this is some straight up fucking like murder shit. I was like, oh my God, like that's nuts.
Dude, this was a second act twist that I was like, holy shit, that came out of nowhere. Like, you know what I mean? Like, the movie doesn't really set it up, and I think that works in its sort of, in its favor. Like, it sets it up, but not overtly. Like, you know, it's not like, it's not like in your face.
And it kind of draws our attention away from it. Like, we kind of forget a little bit, so when it comes back, we're like, oh, okay, shit. Like,
yeah. Well, it draws our attention away from it, like, in a way, because, like, Ernesto is pretty likable. He didn't really do anything, like, in this last sort of 10 minutes of meeting Miguel that's like, oh, shit, this guy's, like, he's not all he's cracked up to be kind of thing. But then Hector busts in. He's like, those were my songs you took. They're my songs that made you famous. And then we find out about his murder, essentially.
Right, yeah. The guy that's just like... Yeah, and this is where Miguel kind of confirms that Hector, in fact, did actually play with Ernesto. But I was not expecting this. But you know, and they start going through, you know, like the movie where he talks about, you know, I would, you know, I would change heaven and earth or blah blah blah, and ends up literally being some of the exact same dialogue that Ernesto says when he murders him. It's like, God damn, dude, you even took the murder of one of your partners and like profiteered off of it, like the literal scene of it. Like, Jesus Christ, man, that's fucking crazy.
So apparently this scene where he kind of doubles over and because he's been poisoned, this is the first time in a Pixar movie where we see a character actually die.
Ah.
Yeah, that's not off screen.
See, that's what I was talking about, man. They'd never fucking kill anybody. That's why this scene kind of got me. I was like, wow, they're getting into some straight up murder now. That's kind of dark.
Did you ever watch Up?
I did not.
Okay, so Up has a pretty awesome opening sort of 10 minutes. I don't want to spoil it for you, but it's kind of it's a montage, but it's a really well done montage, and you see the death of a character, like a kind of life, mm-hmm. And it's done off screen. And like, look, it is impactful, but this is just as impactful.
Oh God, yeah.
Like, I love the kind of like the flashback filter that they use. It looks fucking beautiful, man. And Hector's sort of realization, like, you know, you poisoned me, and Dela Cruz is like, you're confusing movies with reality, you know. He's still trying to get away with it, but basically, Hector calls. Hector. Dela Cruz calls security, and he gets him taken care of.
Yeah,
that's his word. Have him taken care of.
Yeah, he's not well. Have him taken care of.
Yeah, but I love Dela Cruz's kind of like thing here. Like, you don't believe those. You don't believe that, do you, Miguel? Like, you know, like he wants to maintain the illusion. Miguel's like, you're gonna give me your blessing. He's still gonna give that to me, and then he just fucking rips up the pedal.
Yeah, like he's not even gonna take any kind of liability of this kid coming, you know, this kid making it back to ruin all of this for him. You know, if he gets back, you know, not only will he tell people how much of a piece of shit that De La Cruz is, but at the same time, you know, he'll put the picture of Hector on the ofrenda, and you know, he'll wound up coming back and saying something about it. Either way, he's just kind of, you know, like kind of just trying to think of the right word, just like snubbing out anybody who could expose this awful secret that he's had. I mean, for
facade.
Just, yeah, this decades, man, fucking decades.
Yeah, man. Coco gets thrown in this little sort of pit. This actually looks really nice. It's not a set, but you know, it's really designed really well. It looks beautiful. And we find out that Hector's being forgotten. And this is basically where we find out that, you know, Hector is Coco's father.
Yeah, I love it. This is a really good reveal. I honestly did not see this coming.
No, man. This movie hits you with like two twists, like back to back. It's fucking great, and they're both like really kind of they're twists, but they're both like backed up by emotion. Like the way that they revealed, they're very emotional. Like I really feel for Hector here. This is that moment where you were talking about, where, you know, Hector's not really a character that we kind of start out liking, but, you know, eventually we start to sympathize with him.
Right. Yeah. Totally.
I dig it. And this is obviously where Miguel finds out that, oh shit, you're the one in the photo, not De La Cruz. You're my great-great-grandfather, not De La Cruz. It's fucking awesome, man. And is this where we get the flashback where he specifically wrote Remember Me for Coco?
I think so.
I think it is.
Yeah. Because,
I fucking love this.
Yeah, and like I said, I love that. Anytime we're doing something from the past, there's always that great amber colored filter people use on a lot of stuff.
Oh my god, this is where my heartstrings kind of start to tug a little bit. Coco singing "Remember Me" to a young Coco. Remember me, know that I'm with you, the only way that I can be. And she's just the character models are so cute, the voices are cute, the music that they play in the background is amazing. It's just an animated movie like this there's no animated movie that's made me feel this way, and I just it's fucking beautiful, man. Like we gotta move on.
So you need a hug.
I'm getting glossy eyed just talking about this, man. This is like, this is where because this last half hour of this movie is like, let's move on. But I didn't write Remember Me for the world. I wrote it for Coco. And Ernesto just stole that shit. Like, how heinous is that?
Yeah, like, man, that's, you know, fucked up.
Absolutely. But like I said, Miguel realizes, hey, you're who I've been looking for. And who rescues them?
I can't pronounce this fucking this spirit animal of his great great grandmother, right? Imelda, right?
Imelda, yeah.
Imelda, sorry.
I think it's Pepito. Pepito is the name of the spirit animal, I believe.
Okay, cool.
But I love that Imelda and Hector, like, Imelda just fucking hates him.
Oh yeah, like
Hector.
Yeah, like the chemistry between them is really good. And especially I love seeing Dante actually get turned into like a real spirit animal.
Dude, that was cool. I like that, man. I was like, oh, wow, this is fucking cool.
Because as soon as he does, he like gets those wings and jumps off and then just plummets straight down. And I was like, Jesus Christ, fucking can't get right, dog.
Fucking retard. It's retard. It's cool, man. This again, this last half hour of this movie is so emotionally charged, and it's good. But we essentially get this kind of like reunited moment with Imelda and God, I can't speak today, man.
reunion?
Jesus Christ. What is wrong with me?
You're a fucking lawyer.
Reunion. I'm as can't get right as this dog today. Imelda, he spends 5 minutes with you and I have to fish him out of a sinkhole. You know what I mean? Like, you're 100% right, Collin. Like the chemistry, you can feel the kind of the lost love between these two. I dig it.
Yeah, especially later on as she starts realizing the circumstances of his death and and exactly like what really went down, then we kind of get to see that you know, she's very tough on him at first, but it really doesn't last that long.
And this is an important moment for Miguel. He's like, you know, there's nothing more important than family. Hector should be on our friend. He's part of our family. And then, you know, Imelda's just so... She's so stubborn in her stance. No, he left his family. He's an outcast.
Yeah, and I love, yeah, so basically, and that was his fight with De La Cruz, is that he was done touring, and he was like, man, I want to go home, you know, I want to see my family, and obviously that's not something that she knows, but it's great to see that he was actually like, no, like, I'm leaving, blah, 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 and that's what prompted De La Cruz to murder him, because he's like, you know, I'm basically, my golden goose is leaving me, I'm not going to have anybody here to, like, write these number one hit songs for me. But one thing that I really like is she actually says, how many times do I have to turn you away? And it's like this is not the first time that they've bumped into each other, and I'm sure Hector's been like, listen, like, you know, I'm starting to be forgotten, like, can somebody on the other side put a picture up for me, and blah, blah, blah. And that really kind of makes me dislike her character so much more, because it's like, I get it, like, I understand he abandoned the family, and that's what you think, and that's what you assumed has, like, happened. But, you know, like, does it deserve, like, a final death? Does it deserve to be, like, completely forgotten? Because, like you said, you know, both of them, she even said, both, you know, we both just made compromises for what we wanted. But, you know, like, I don't know, I'm kind of torn, because, like, I understand, like, he kind of left the family and went out to pursue this career. But, like, you didn't know that he was literally on his way back when he got killed. Like, you have no idea that. And, you know, here we are at the precipice of him almost disappearing. And, you know, it's just like it's tragic, just in her anger. You know, she's so angry that she doesn't consider, you know, not doesn't consider it, but, you know, obviously there's no way for her to know exactly what happened to Hector. I mean, even he didn't know. But there's so much that gets, like, left out. It's almost like a tragic thing where it's like, oh God, you know, had she known that the whole time, you know, and they've been here, that would have been a completely different story. But it's like, God, that just sucks. Like, how many years have they spent down here together, and he could have gotten his picture put up, and now we're at, like I said, the precipice of him disappearing. It's like, oh God, man, that's fucking gut-wrenching.
Yeah, I think that's one of the cornerstones of this movie, right? Like, I mean, the fact that she's so kind of, like, stubborn and really, really, like, it's basically an immovable object. She's not, he left the family, that's it. I don't want to hear another word about it. I'm not hearing another word or reason. I'm out. Like, you right. know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And I guess that's where the compromise comes in. Like, there, that's the importance of this, of the, that's the message of the movie, I guess.
Right.
But basically, she kind of comes around because Hector starts to buckle because he's being forgotten by Coco. And she's like, you know, Miguel's like, you don't have to forgive him, but we shouldn't forget him.
Right. Yeah, that's a great line. That's really good.
Fucking powerful. Fucking powerful. And then they don't necessarily make amends, but, you know, they do press on. They, like, I like that. I like that they don't, you know, they don't immediately make amends.
They're just civil. You know, they're civil to try and get through this. Yeah. They're like, yeah, okay, let's figure all this shit out later, and then you and I will figure our shit out.
But they go to De La Cruz's show. They basically break in the fucking backstage. And they confront I love Imelda and Hector confronting De La Cruz. I'm the love of your life.
Oh yeah, I didn't say it. Maybe I don't know. And I love Miguel.
I don't know. I'm still angry at you.
Yeah, Miguel. That's not what I heard.
It's good, man. It's good. This confrontation's good. But this kind of, like, short mini fight scene kind of breaks out into the stage, and I love Imelda kind of, like, getting raised up the platform, having no idea what the fuck to do, and she just sings. I love the singing. I like, you know what I mean? Like, it's cool. She just starts singing, and, like, Hector just helps her out.
Yeah, it's, I like that. Cool. It's very, like, improvised, and it's a situation that's going to force them, like, kind of to work together again. And, you know, when you start, well, if you can get over this hurdle together, you know, it kind of starts breaking down those the armor, you know, that she's kind of built up, like, against them, you know, to say, oh yeah, we actually do kind of make a good team. I do like that. It kind of breaks down that anger that she's had against him the whole time.
Not to mention the, like, her voice is fucking amazing. I'm just gonna play a little bit, if that's cool.
Do it.
Llorona de azul celeste.
I love her, man. I dig it.
Yeah, I her voice is just pristine.
Sure, yeah, like, I think that's another thing we should note as well. There's not really that many sort of famous actors in this movie. They went for, like, genuine sort of Mexican names, which is cool.
Mm-hmm.
Or Latino names, I guess. Latin names.
Yeah, cool, I think it's cool because you could have just like really crammed, like you're talking about like the actors wise, like you're talking about, yeah, like, yeah,
in real life, yeah,
right. They could have just like crammed this, like like when you look at something like the new Lion King that's coming out and it's got like Beyonce and James Earl Jones, whatever, and like
Childish Gambino,
right. You could have just like crammed this full of people like that, but it's interesting because here's a movie that, I mean, this was I think shattered a lot of Pixar's other films, especially in Mexico. And it kind of gave, you know, especially for the boy that plays Miguel, but for a lot of the people who are in the movie, I mean, I didn't really know a whole lot of them myself. So I'm like, well, I wonder what kind of breakthrough that gave some of these people being on this successful of a movie for their careers. I hope it went far for a lot of them.
$800 million.
Yeah, that's fucking crazy, man. I think they said it blew past.
It's the fifth highest grossing for Pixar.
Yeah, I was reading about it in Mexico, and apparently the 2012 Avengers was like the biggest movie there for a long time. And yeah, after like a week, this movie like shattered past it, just went flying. I was like, damn. I mean, which I obviously, you know, I'm sure Brave is a real big hit in Ireland or Scotland, but you know, it's kind of I can definitely see, because there's not a whole lot of movies about this culture and about this heritage, right, and about
it's
this tradition.
It's unique as fuck.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, that's one thing you know, you can say, oh, you know, they're just trying to be diverse because it's politically correct or whatever. And it's like, you know, maybe that is also like, maybe it is kind of true. But at the same time, like, it doesn't make it any less interesting. No. I've always loved like hearing about this kind of holiday. And it's something that, you know, I personally don't celebrate because it's just not part of my tradition. But that doesn't mean that I can't find it interesting. Or if I wasn't in Mexico, I would love to be there to see that. That would be awesome.
It's exactly like fucking 100%. Jesus Christ, Colin, you hit the nail on the head so much better than I do. Why do I even podcast? Like, why do I even do it?
I'm literally just laying in bed making this shit up. No, I'm just kidding.
Have you thought about, you know, going solo? Because don't.
No, I'm
sorry. Don't leave me behind.
I'd be such a bore.
Eventually, Imelda tries to give Miguel, you know, her blessing. I'll give you my blessing to go home to put up our photos in the ofrenda. And Miguel's like, and never to play music again. And Imelda's like, no, to never forget how much your family loves you. Fucking love it.
Yeah, that's good. I like that.
But that's interrupted by De La Cruz. You know, you're not going anywhere. They get into this little fight. Dude, when he pushes Imelda, I was like, oh, that's fucking pretty solid for a Pixar movie. But basically, he's just kind of like in this, I guess this is like a hostage situation now. God damn.
And basically what he says, you know, is like, you have to be willing to do whatever it takes to seize your moment. That's his big motto. It's like all about seizing your moment. He's like, I'll poison someone. I'll kill a child who like I'm like semi attached to now because I've been under the kind of illusion that this kid's my grandson, you know, and it's like, but I'll throw that kid off a bridge just to keep my secrets. It's like, crazy. Fuck, man, that's dark.
Have you ever seen Monsters, Inc.?
Yeah, a long time ago.
Okay, so one of the problems I had about this movie, probably my biggest problem, but look, doesn't really tarnish the movie for me. This movie, the villain is exposed the same way the villain in Monsters, Inc. is exposed.
Oh, yeah. Let's, I kind of forgot about that.
Point a camera at him and, and let's expose him for who he is. Look, it's clever. It's clever, but, I mean, they've done it before.
Right, yeah. Yeah, I'm glad you pointed that out. I didn't even remember that.
They point a camera at him and basically the hundreds of thousands of people see him. And he's exposed to be a murderer. You know, I guess that's how it works in Mexico. No proof. Let's fucking charge him.
Yeah, like they literally film him throwing Miguel off the bridge. It's like, holy shit. Like, that's, you literally could not get more incriminating than that, man. Like, yeah. But I love Dante's trying to save him, and Dante can't get to him, and he's just, I was just like, dude, like, this was the only part of the movie I was like, oh, I know exactly what's coming next. And obviously the,
oh yeah, that's just kids movie stuff,
right? Yeah, I was like, well, it really would have thrown me through a loop had Miguel just like hit the ground and splatted and be like, oh, wow, like that's
Spider-Man 2 style fucking Gwen Stacy break back.
Yeah, it's like, oh yeah, god.
I do love Dela Cruz coming out, like, you know, trying to sing, trying to start it up again, and everyone just fucking booing him.
Oh yeah, it's great. It's kind of like seeing the hyenas turn on Scar in The Lion King. It's like, oh.
I could have done without Dela Cruz getting belled again. Because like Dela Cruz's like thing was his reputation, and I love that, like, his downfall, like, you know, we saw his downfall with him being booed. Like, that was enough for me. I didn't need to see him being hit by the bell, but whatever.
Yeah, fuck it.
It's kids movie shit. But, you know, it's, you know, what goes around comes around, or what bells around, I guess. What a fucking
God.
Jesus.
That joke. God, that joke was so bad I just shit my pants.
Should I just go fuck myself right now? I'm gonna, Jesus Christ. But basically, yeah, Hector and Imelda give him his blessing and he goes home. No conditions. This is sad. This whole moment is sad. Did you notice, like, throughout the movie as well, how, like, he's slowly, if you look at his fingers and his hands, he's like, the skeleton sort of deterioration is still continuing. They don't focus on it, but it's happening still.
Right, yeah, especially in the scenes when
he's playing at the thing, right? To get into Dela Cruz's palace.
Yeah, that, and right before they send him back, as you know, as he's as he's disappearing, you know, you really even start to see it in Miguel's cheeks. Like, he really starts going like ethereal. Like, he starts, you know, you kind of start seeing the skeleton like really well, and you're like, oh shit, man, like, you gotta go.
Yeah, so yeah, for sure, man. But like, he returns from he went from the land of the dead to Mexico. That's a real trade up there for you, isn't it?
Yeah, right. Who's your,
had to put in a jab.
Who's your travel agent, dude? Jesus.
But Miguel, I love that he immediately goes to the ofrenda. Just like, no hesitation. He's like, I gotta go, man. But Abuelita, you know, she tries to intervene. She's like, give me the fucking guitar, dick.
God, yeah, that shit pissed me off.
Sorry, he doesn't go to the ofrenda. Fucking hell, Jesus Christ, he goes straight to Coco.
Right, yeah, because he needs him to remember.
To remember. And this is the part where I full go tears. Like, I guarantee you, this is me in the cinema, watching it next to my mate, I'm just like, I'm good, man. I'm a man. I'm feeling strong.
Are you crying? No, I got Sprite in my eyes.
No, there's smoke in here.
Yeah, right.
But yeah, man. I can't with this scene. Colin, I need you to talk about this scene first.
Well, like, I love...
You need to be a robot if you don't like this part. I'm sorry.
Well, it's okay. No, I'm just kidding. I like it because, you know, not only do we finally see Coco kind of snap out of whatever, you know, this kind of dementia stupor that she's been in, you know, stupor's not the right word, but, you know, just this kind of like funk. It's not only does it snap her out of it, and that's great, but also at the same time to see Miguel's grandmother, the look on her face, you know, and she looks over and actually calls her by her name, and it's like, oh my god, man, like, that's just like, I think that hits home for so many people, and like, obviously you, and it's like, I've talked about this before, like, as I look very different from how I did when I was a kid. You know, I shave my head now and I have a beard. My beard is red where the rest of my hair is like black. And, you know, there's people who literally graduated high school with me that look me right in the face and don't recognize me. So as my grandmother was getting older as well, it was damn near impossible. I mean, she was having trouble recognizing people that looked the same for the last like 20 years. So when she saw me, she was just very like every single time, you know, hey, do you know who that is? That's Collin. And she'd be Collin, like she would always look at me and be like, wow, you know, like I didn't think, you know, like when did you grow out a beard, you know? And I've had a beard for like 10 years. So I think especially with when you talk about in terms of getting older, you know, people understand like, yeah, you know, I'm going to physically fall apart eventually, you know, I'm going to die. But the majority of people are like, I just hope my memory doesn't go. I just hope that I don't start forgetting things. And I've heard that from so many people and I feel the exact same way. I'm actually really fond of like and proud of my memory because I can remember a lot of things. And I would hate to see that start slipping as I'm getting older. It's especially with Alzheimer's, especially in the U.S. There's been like a lot of debate over this is just kind of like a little side thing. But there's been a lot of debate over self-euthanization for people who have Alzheimer's and don't want to just descend like down into that. And I totally understand it. No, who would want to become like that? It's kind of like Brad Pitt at the end of Benjamin Button. At the end of Benjamin Button, you know, and he's paranoid and throwing things at people. And it's like, you know, and that's obviously a pretty severe case. But just to constantly be in this kind of like fog and not seeing where you are, it's like, man, fuck that. And I think it's great, you know, when she, and not only that, Coco, it's kind of like one of the first times she really opens her eyes. And yes. I think that's great because the eyes are, you know, kind of like the window to the soul. And the fact that they're just closed the whole time, it's like, yeah, the lights are on, but nobody's really home. Right. Yeah. So I think it's great that not only can here's this thing with Miguel where they've been going on about music the whole time. No music, no music, no music. And not only does the music end up being the thing that fixes the problems in the land of the dead, but it also fixes the problems with Coco and with her daughter, you know, being Miguel's grandmother, and kind of brings this peace to the family, not one last time, but while Coco's still alive, it kind of all brings them together one last time, which is another big theme of this movie is, you know, music tore us apart, but the shoes are what kept us together. And it's like, it's not really the shoes that have kept you together. It's just kind of the insert thing here that we all do together and say that it's the thing that keeps us together. Whereas it really ends up being the music at the end that kind of comes in and saves the day. And I like that a lot.
Sweet Jesus. How do I follow that? Yeah, God damn it. I'm not going to go into why this scene makes me feel what it feels. It's obvious. Pixar, they're definitely trying to evoke an emotional moment, and I think they're successful for the most part. What I really like about this scene is the music reminding her of who she is and like who her father was.
Yeah.
Because like music plays a definite sort of part. Like, do you watch Black Mirror?
I've seen a few of them.
Okay, there's an episode called Crocodile. In that episode, it's basically they use this technology where they kind of like help you remember things. They can literally see your memories, and like what they do is they give you, for example, if you are near a brewery, they give you a bottle of beer. And like you just kind of like it just sits there and like your senses kind of like take you back to that place. They also play like music, you know, because if the song was in like on in the background, then like you'd be immediately kind of like transported back to that place.
That's, oh, yeah. I think I actually have seen that one episode. It's like an insurance I have seen that one. That's crazy. Out of the few I've seen, you're talking about one that I actually fucking watched.
Yeah, well, I mean, I just thought that kind of applies here because, like, that's what music does, right? Like, I mean, it like, if you hear a song, then you'll immediately kind of connect it to something that was important in your life when you heard it or something like that. Yeah, like, even absolutely. When it wasn't important.
Yeah,
like,
there's, you know, there's always music that, especially, first album I ever bought was Michael Jackson's Thriller. And that whole album is like I think I bought that in 2000. Yeah, it would have been 2012. It was the 20th anniversary. Or no, 2002, not 2012. Yeah, first album I ever bought was fucking 6 years ago. No, it was 2002 when I bought it. But that totally, you know, hearing Beat It or Billie Jean or Thriller, you know, and hearing my parents be like, okay, seriously, you're wearing us out. You got to turn that album off. but yeah, it just sometimes it hits you, the nostalgia hits you so hard that it's kind of like, it doesn't make me like sick, but it just kind of gives me like, it's just kind of like
goosebumps.
Yeah. It just sucks the air right out of your lungs.
For sure, man. Coco, Elena, what's wrong, mija? Nothing, mama. Nothing at all. Oh,
so
good. Good God. Fucking waterworks. But anyway, that's it. That's, there's a story right there. Like, Coco kept her father's letters, poems he wrote, and then things like that. It's goddamn beautiful, man.
Right, and this is securing Hector's future, you know, basically his future Day of the Deads, where, you know,
he's able to visit.
Right, and we saw this rule before with Cheech, where it's like you can't just run back and remember someone. It has to be passed down. It has to be, you know, even though – because it wouldn't have worked if Coco – because, you know, you could have said, oh, we'll just get Miguel back and Coco dies and whatever Miguel remembers. And it's like, no, like it has to be almost like taught to you in the world of the living. Like somebody has to introduce you to that. Like it has to be – like, and that's kind of what makes it special, is the fact that somebody has to pass that down to you in order for me to come on. You know, it would be a lot less special if you could just grab anybody you wanted to and had them remember you. But it's the fact that it's like your flesh and blood, and it has to be passed down like a torch. I thought that was really cool. So her busting out the letters, I mean, just it kind of secured it for so many generations. There's, you know, that's with obviously Miguel and then his grandmother. And I mean, there's so many people right there that it's like locking in all of this different stuff. I thought that was great. It's like securing all these different ways for Hector to be able to get back later on. It's like that's awesome. That's really cool. Not only does Coco remember now, but everybody will remember him now. It's like that's fucking awesome. I like that a lot.
It's beautiful. It's beautiful, man. But we cut to a year later. Forget you. Delacruz's face. Love it. Basically, Hector's remembered as a hero that he was. Well, hero, but you know. As who he was, the person who wrote all of the songs, you know, not just Remember Me, but everything that De La Cruz claimed did himself.
Yeah, this is the only part I kind of laughed at. I was like, yeah, because we definitely give everyone their artistic credit when they work on stuff. Like, it made me think of like Bob Kane and Bill Finger and, like, you know, people who just get fucked out of
Bill Finger, especially, right?
Oh, dude, like, God, yeah, I can't even get into that, but, like...
Well, that's for another time.
Yeah, same thing with a lot of comic books, so Steve Ditko and Jack Kirby, but, you know, everybody remembers Stan Lee, so, like, it was kind of cool to see that, but I was like, yeah, what fucking fairy tale world do you live in, where, like, they actually start giving this person credit, like, later on. I was like, God, that's, I get it, it's a kid's movie, we want to, like, write all the wrongs and stuff, but it's like, damn, dude, there's just so much stuff like that in the world, it kind of pisses you off sometimes.
For sure. But Miguel's introducing the newbie to the ofrenda and why it's important for us to remember family. And we get a new face on the ofrenda. Really, really sad. It's Coco. She's passed away. But she's going to be remembered. God damn it. This movie just keeps gut punching me. I feel like I'm in a boxing ring and I just keep getting knocked out. Like, I'm just like, ugh, I'm out. See ya. I'm tapping out. But yeah, Hector goes to cross a bridge and confirmed he's allowed to cross the bridge.
Oh yeah, just the look of like uncertainty on his face. It's like, well, I would kind of be like, well, you're here right now, which means somebody definitely remembers you, so I think you're okay, but like I definitely understand your nervousness.
Absolutely, man. But this is one of the most powerful sort of images in the movie. You know, he gets across with Hector Sorry, Hector gets across with Imelda and Coco. It's fucking beautiful.
Yeah, and all of them, like, linking hands up together and walking across the bridge. Like, oh, that's fucking good, man. That looks great.
Powerful,
and just,
man.
Like, him watching his feet, like, he's kind of like, like, is this thing going to sink in on me? Like, he's kind of nervous as he's walking and stuff. And just the realization that it's finally happening, that it's like, it's this is reality. You know, you're not going to start sinking into the ground and all that other shit. It's like, oh man, that's fucking great. That's got to be such a relief to him. You know, it's like playing a video game and trying to beat the same spot over and over and over again. And you can't beat it. And you finally are just like, oh, Jesus Christ, that's fucking God. I'm so glad I'm over that part.
Oh, 100%, man. But we close on this. I guess like it's like a closing montage. We get Miguel's song. This is the last time I'll play it, but it's fucking beautiful. I love this song. Like, you know, they can close on such a downer, but they bring it up so well. Have a listen, man. This is fucking great.
Oh, dude, yeah, especially, you know, and every beat of my corazón, and I was like, hey, I know what that means, but yeah, I love the ending of this. One question that I have, though, as I know that Miguel's no longer, this isn't like a gripe or anything, I'm just kind of curious. I know he's no longer like in the spirit realm like he was before, but do you think he can still see all of them, or is it just kind of?
I don't think so. I think he knows that they're there. I think he, like, because he's been to the other side, he can, like he definitely knows how, he definitely knows that they're there, if that makes sense.
Okay, yeah, because I was like, okay, he's not acknowledging any of them, but, you know, it's still great. That's what's kind of great about it, is that, like, I don't have to see them anymore. Like, I know they're there. I like that a lot.
It's cool, man. It's cool. That's Coco. That's our first animated movie ever on Midnight Double Feature. That's our first movie that's not rated M or PG-13.
Yeah, right. This is probably about as kiddie as it's gonna get.
As kiddie as it's gonna get. But I was just scrolling through our feed. This actually might be the deepest movie that we've covered, maybe to me. But in terms of themes, I think thematically.
Yeah, and on a personal level as well. I mean, it's not like we never went out and hunted Zodiac, and we were never in Django Unchained, and, you know, we weren't in the hospital for the Void. It's like, okay, this is about as close as it's going to get for us.
Yeah. So, I mean, obviously, you can't see me, Collin, but this really elicited a lot of emotional sort of a lot of emotional sort of stuff from me when I watched this with my dad, because, you know, I think I've said on the podcast, my grandmother passed away not too long ago. So he's like, oh, I'm going to bed. But I knew, you know, he was pretty upset. So
right.
I did feel a little bad showing this to him. But, you know, at the same time, when I was like, hey, we're going to watch a cartoon, he's like, oh, a cartoon. I was like, you deserve this.
Yeah.
But yeah, man, closing thoughts on Coco.
I like it a lot. You know, it's on Netflix for anybody who wants to watch it right now too. And what I do like is that not only is there the English version, there's actually a version completely in Spanish. And it's like, okay, that's cool. That's good. Like, I'm glad that there's not just like, oh, you have to watch this in English, or, you know, oh, you've got to go.
Some inclusion.
Right. Yeah. It's like, oh no, you have to go and find, like, you have to go in and change the settings because English is the predominant language, even though this is a movie where half of it is spoken in Spanish and we're literally celebrating, you know, like celebrating the traditional holiday. I like the fact that there's actually just like a Spanish version of it, which it's not like, oh no, we just, here's the shitty overdub that we do. It's like, no, we actually went out of our way to get like good people to do like a Spanish version of it. Cause I mean, how could you not, you know, you're taking so much away from the tradition, from that tradition, that to not have that would be almost kind of like a crime. So I'm glad that they did that. I kind of want to watch just the Spanish version just to like learn the songs in Spanish, or like, just up my Spanish like just a little bit, But all in all, I liked it. I watched it with my girlfriend and her brother. They both liked that. They both liked it a lot too. It's again, it's just personally not for me. It's just not my kind of movie. But at the same time, it can't be denied how good of a movie it is. And it's something that if it were maybe like a hair darker, I would probably own it. You know, if it were like PG-13, like pushing the PG-13 kind of thing, I could really get behind it. And they're like, okay, cool. Like this is really neat. I mean, especially with the animation. If you take that kind of animation and I think really get kind of dark with it, there's a great juxtaposition there. But all in all, I'm going to say, for me personally, like a 7 or an 8 out of 10, just because you can't deny how good the movie is. But at the same time, even though it's such a great movie, I just know it's not my kind of movie, but I can look past that and be like, man, you know, I understand that's my own personal bias and I can't let that affect. I'm trying to not let that affect what I think objectively of the movie. And it's got a great plot. There are some really good twists and turns that you don't see coming. And when they do, they hit you just like a ton of bricks, you know, and you were so surprised to find out about De La Cruz. And then at the same time, we're finding out about Hector, like literally in the next scene. So they really took their time with like setting that up. And then once they set it up, I mean, man, it just like we go from De La Cruz being like the hero of the hour to just being like such a fucking villainous piece of shit, you know, and then we see the truth about what happened to Hector. And that all happens so fast, which I kind of like and I kind of dislike. I feel like it's almost like too sharp of a turn to reveal those like back to back, like right behind each other. It feels a little like soapy, kind of like soap opera ish. But other than that, that's about the biggest gripe you can really make about this movie. You know, if you don't like it, I understand, you know, Disney and Pixar is not for everyone, but you can't deny that it's a great movie and it's got really great music behind it. And you know, I feel like a lot of people worry about death in a sense of, you know, what's my legacy? What am I leaving behind? And this movie kind of conquers a lot of that, but at the same time is, you know, entertaining and has a lot of humor in it as well. And it's something that everybody can kind of enjoy. There's something about it in it for everyone. And I always appreciate movies like that much more than something that just caters to one audience. Sometimes if you can pull it off well, then it's a miracle. But yeah, I mean, I would definitely watch this again somewhere down the road, but yeah, I'm going to say about a 7 out of 10 for me personally. What do you think?
Cool. Obviously, I love this fucking movie. this thing, man, it shook me like movies don't usually do. Last time I saw this movie, like I said, with my dad, he went upstairs and I just kind of like sat there during the credits and I'm just like, God damn it. I didn't really have like actual tears. It's kind of like impossible for a movie to actually make me cry, but that's not to say that this movie didn't shake me to my core. They do such a good job of like hitting you with these gut punches, but then like at the end, even just with this song that I just played, they do such a good job of creating like this happy ending. Mm-hmm. Like, you know what I mean? Pixar are just so damn good at that, man. And this movie is just such a good study into the creation of art and what it takes to, you know, actually be yourself and break away from the traditional sort of chains, what could be perceived as chains of tradition and family and, you know, what's expected of you and things like that. And it's just so deep and stuff like that, man. And it's not only that, but to kind of like convey that and like to do it in a way that's understandable to children, like holy shit, like that's crazy. Like it achieves what film a kid's movie should do, I think, and that's teach a kid a lesson, teach them about important things in life, while it's also making grown men cry. So look, I'm gonna leave it there for me, man, because you know I'm gonna break down. But yeah, this movie's incredible. This movie's a 10 out of 10 for me. It like I said, it's not only one of the best animated movies I've seen, but it's one of the best movies I've seen in my life. I do have a couple of listener comments. I don't know if you've got them, but I've got a few here.
No, I actually didn't catch those. You go right ahead.
Oh, awesome. Well, I did put up like a post earlier in the week. I guess it was just me kind of like ranting a little bit. I'll read the post. Quotations. Why the hell would I want to watch a children's movie? Someone said this to me when I said, hey, you want to go watch Incredibles 2? Someone said that to me, and I was just like, I have so much disgust for you right now.
Yeah.
I'll read the quote, the caption. Well, this is a response that I've heard more than once. It's easy to palm off a movie solely because it presents itself as something on a surface level. There's absolutely no argument that animated films are generally targeted towards children. However, an argument can be made that although good animated movies teach children important lessons, teach children important lessons and values. Oftentimes, these movies can resonate heavily with adults. Pixar Animation Studios have been doing this for a long time. Toy Story taught us about the dangers of jealousy and the urge to be wanted. Finding Nemo delved into what it means to be a father. Yeah, blah, blah. I already talked about this. That's why for our next feature presentation, we've decided to cover Pixar's latest film, Coco. Not only is the film filled with heart and humor, it also goes deep into the importance of family. Do not simply wave this off as simply just being a kid's movie. This is, without a doubt, the heaviest children's movie you'll see. Liana Fallon commented, the majority of Disney movies aren't even for kids. People don't watch animated films because they're, quote, just for kids, end quote. They're just ignorant and plain losers. I agree with you, Liana. I don't think it's fair to kind of like write off a movie just because it's animated. You know, I think, Colin, even though you weren't as high on this movie as I was, I think you can definitely agree with that, right?
Oh, God, yeah. Like, I love, like, I'm actually a big fan of, like, the DC animated universe. I'm a big fan of, you know, Flashpoint Paradox, The Death of Superman, and Teen Titans versus Justice League, and those are all really great, and people... Or like the animated Killing Joke or the Dark Knight Returns, and people want to try to take something away from that just because it's animated. And it's like, man, like I personally like animation that's R-rated. I mean, I just like R-rated stuff. That's just kind of, you know, just kind of what I grew up watching and what I like. But at the same time, just because something is animated doesn't automatically, you know, oh, man, it's going to be a kids movie. It's like, yeah, but there can be good kids movies that kind of have these deeper kind of traits to them, or we're talking about heavy themes, especially with death. I can't really think of another movie outside of, you know, like the Halloween Tree that I've talked about where they deal with death like that, and they actually kind of like face it head on, and literally, I mean, there's parts in this movie where he's staring death like right in the eye. And to be able to come back from that and show the importance of family, but at the same time realizing that, you know, just because I'm playing music doesn't mean I can't be a part of this family. That's tough, you know, for any kind of film to pull off. And especially like we were talking about earlier, there's going to be a lot of pros with doing an animated movie, but there's also a lot of cons. And, you know, making people feel something from just an image of someone that's not even really there. And they just do such a great job. That I don't think that you can take anything away. Just, oh, well, that's just like an animated movie. It's like, hey, yeah. Do you even know how fucking hard it is to make animated movies?
Yeah, I know.
And then B, at the same time, to make them so realistic and so lifelike that we can actually relate with them. I think there's really something to be said about that.
Yeah, 100%, man. I fully agree. Recent competition winner, Michael Claudio. Recently watched this movie. It's a good movie. I thoroughly enjoyed it. Looking forward to the pod. Adam Talbot, I don't know. Up was pretty heavy. Definitely agree. Up was really, really heavy. Seth Trueblood, Studio Ghibli introduced me to full-length animated films, and my love only grew from there. I know I should, but I've actually never seen a Studio Ghibli movie. I've heard that they are deep.
I haven't seen one either.
Yeah, Danny Hartley, Amanda and I loved the hell out of this movie, no pun intended. really meant it though. Pixar always comes through with original ideas and fantastic stories to accompany them. WALL-E is still my number three in my whole book. And then we just kind of like kind of went through and I guess ranked our favorite Pixar movies. Danny Hartley's number one, Wall-E, two, The Incredibles, three, Coco, four, Inside Out, five, he's torn between Toy Story 2 and Finding Dory. Yeah, well, I had number one in The Incredibles because it's a superhero movie. Two, Coco, three, Toy Story 3, four, Wall-E, five, Finding Nemo. And if I had a sixth choice, it'd be Ratatouille. What would you use? Did you have a list?
Yeah, fuck no. I don't like, like, honestly, I don't
like animation.
Dude, I just, like I said, the day Disney Pixar starts pumping out PG-13 and R-rated fucking movies, man, I'll be like right there. But there's they're good movies. I will say, if you're going to ask me what my favorite ones are, I'm a little bit more old school. Obviously, the first Toy Story, you know, Monsters, Inc. And I haven't really seen just like a whole lot of them outside of that.
Well, I haven't seen Brave, I haven't seen The Good Dinosaur, and I haven't seen Cars 2 or 3. So
no, yeah, I've seen none of those. I think I've seen like half of the first Cars movie, and that was okay. I didn't mind it.
It was all right, yeah.
But yeah, there's just, I think that Toy Story probably takes the cake for me, but it's just because, I mean, that was just so monumental. I was the perfect age for that when it came out.
Me too.
Well,
it came out the year I was born, I think.
Damn, yeah, I remember having it on. It was one of the few movies that as a child, like, I had, and it was mine. And, like it wasn't something that I shared with the family. It wasn't something that anybody else really wanted to watch. You know, I remember watching it by myself, and you got a friend in me.
Oh.
That whole scene is just, like, so good.
Brandon Newman.
And I think that Toy Story resonates a little bit more with me because it's about having to grow up and put away childish things. And, you know, like, not that that's like something that I struggle with, but especially as you get older and, you know, you're really into, you know, film and television shows and kind of fandoms and like cosplaying and stuff like that. There's a lot of people that are, you know, kind of like, you know, isn't that a kid's movie? Like, isn't that a little kid thing? Like, why do you, you know, like you're an adult, you know, blah, blah, blah. And I think Toy Story kind of has a lot of those themes for me about putting away, you know, childish things and, you know, and stop being a kid. But I think to a degree, like, you should never do that. Like, that's just such a philosophy of mine of like, never stop being at least partially childish, you know, be professional on the surface. But when people really get to know you, you know, be a fucking little kid all you want, you know, cause it's, I mean, it's, I don't know, you know, it's kind of like a philosophy of mine about that of like, don't just give up those things because other people tell you to. And always, you know, always just do what you want. If that's what you want to do, if you want to go and, you know, go to cosplay and dress up as fucking Thanos and spend $2,000 on a badass costume, do it, man. If that's what you want to do.
For sure.
That's just what I take away from Toy Story personally. But that, if I had to pick one, I'm going to say those, honestly.
That's fucking awesome, man. That trilogy is fucking fantastic, man. I wanted to close with Danny Felcher's comment. A powerful animated movie, not for kids, is Grave of the Fireflies from 1988. Haven't seen that. Animated doesn't always mean children. 100% agree with you, Daniel. Daniel? Jesus, Daniel. Christ. All right. That's it.
Fuck
we
yeah.
are done. Colin, you wanna round us out here?
Yeah, if you guys want to check us out, you can always find us on you know, basically all the podcasting apps. We're on iTunes and I think Stitcher and quite a few of them. You can always shoot us an email, midnightdoublefeature@gmail.com. We've also got our Instagram and Facebook, also just Midnight Double Feature. There's also the after party, which everyone's invited to come join. That's a link to our Facebook group. That's all one word. They're the after party. You know, it's where we post our memes and funny stuff. And I personally, and I've said this before, I'm a little bit more personally biased towards our Instagram. I like that just a little bit more because I feel like there's some, you know, Facebook can get kind of toxic sometimes and you have to scroll through, you know, 60% shit just to see some cool stuff that you like. I personally like Instagram a little bit more, and I think our Instagram's doing a little bit better. I think that's taken off a little bit more. But yeah, basically, if you guys want to check us out on, you can go straight to libsyn.com and find us. If you don't use any apps or you don't download anything, you can go straight to Libsyn and find our RSS feed there. And if you do have the apps, you know, rate and review us, you know, let us know how we're doing, or, you know, if you guys have any suggestions or anything that you guys like to see, just let us know. Shoot us an email at midnightdoublefeature@gmail.com, or, you know, you can always find me and Zoheb on Facebook or, you know, anywhere else. You know, we're always open to hearing suggestions and hearing from people about the show. But until then, I guess we'll catch you guys next time.